Councillor Brame. Welcome, Councillor Brame. And Councillor Rowlands by Councillor Cameron. Welcome, Councillor Cameron. This brings us on to declarations of interest. Does anybody have any interest to declare regarding any items on the agenda? No, thank you. So this brings us to item four, which is the minutes, and these can be found on pages 1 to 10 of the agenda pack. And I'd just like to ask the committee to approve the accuracy of these minutes.
So moved, Chair.
So if proposed and seconded, I'll second that then. Assuming we all agree that by assent, if anybody's got anything to say, could you say that now? Okay, so we agree the minutes, thank you. This brings us to public and member questions. I'm not aware of any member questions, but we do have rather a lot of public questions. So there being rather a lot of questions, especially on one single issue, it's my intention to take these together and then answer them afterwards, because many of the answers would have overlapping information. So I'll still therefore address the questions from Sally Scott, Stephanie Thompson, and Simon Young. Sally is unable to be here, but has requested that I read out her question. She writes, in July 2019, Wirral Borough Council was one of the early local authorities to declare a climate emergency. This declaration affects every area of council responsibility. It is significant that the declaration made by Wirral Borough Council in July 2019 includes a commitment to become a carbon literate organisation, with all elected and employed members of the council undergoing carbon literacy training. 2 years on, it is increasingly clear that catastrophic global climate change is already upon us, and academic climate researchers, meteorologists, and economists, in fact, experts from many different disciplines, are calling for an urgent scaling up of climate crisis action. Action is needed at every level of society, with an increasing number of ordinary citizens ready to do their part. The Committee for Climate Change, who advise the government, have stated very clearly that local authorities are well placed to play a major part in the action, as they have local knowledge and understanding of their area and are probably very well motivated to help their own residents. This was shown to be true during the pandemic and can be true again. The importance of carbon literacy is that if councillors, especially decision makers, need to be aware of the realities of climate change to avoid supporting ill-advised and possibly costly policies, which unintentionally making the climate crisis worse. I'm reading this as I find it. Council staff use procedures to ensure the council's policies are in place, but if staff are not carbon literate, bad information and mistakes will be made. There is a case for saying that all employed staff should be required to undertake professional training as part of their job. As the crisis deepens, Wirral Borough Council needs to become more active in fulfilling their stated commitment to carbon literacy. The reality that finances are very tight for local and regional authorities makes any significant contribution towards climate change a very big ask. But with or without improved financial support, progress towards dealing with climate issues requires a widespread and high degree of carbon literacy. As a Wirral resident, I would like to know how many present councillors have already undertaken or are booked into a carbon literacy training course. Is it possible to know which councillors have not yet taken or signed up to carbon literacy training? What proportion of Wirral Borough Council's staff have already undertaken or are booked onto such a course? What contractual precautions are in place to ensure that workers in companies contracted to work on behalf of the council are required to operate in a climate-sensitive way? How will Wirral Borough Council mount any public information campaign about climate action to help members of the public to appreciate council strategies, which of course need to be visible and verifiable? Significant strides have already been made towards the goal of the council being and becoming carbon neutral by 2030. However, the increasing impact of climate change is here and now, and the risk affecting everyone everywhere. Carbon literacy, as with other information, should not be viewed as a party political matter, and carbon literacy is needed to slow the crisis and mitigate the already present change. I urge this committee to take whatever steps are needed to fulfil the council's commitment to become a carbon literate organisation. So thank you, Sally. I know that you're watching, and we appreciate your question. I'll ensure that the names of councillors who have attended Carbon Literacy are published for you. I know we have trained over 120 members and officers, and we are currently at bronze level in carbon as a carbon literate organisation, aiming, of course, to get to gold. We are very proud of this training, and I'm happy to encourage everyone else to attend this course in order to make decisions while fully informed of the data on the climate emergency. We can also provide you with the proportion of staff that have been trained or signed up. I will ensure that you get details of our contractual precautions regarding climate-sensitive operations, and it's important to note that we now have an environmental impact assessment for all council decisions and reports. I very much welcome your request for information on the council's communication strategy regarding public awareness of the environment and climate emergency. This could well be the most valuable thing we do. I am sure you're aware of the promotion of carbon literacy that is undertaken by the Cool Wirral Partnership too, but you might want to check out their web pages for more information, as well as looking at the council's own pages on the environment. Thank you very much for your question, Sally. I'd now like to ask Stephanie Thompson to ask her question. Is Stephanie present? Thank you, Stephanie.
Chair, whilst the residents taking up the position, can I just ask the procedure for these questions? Have I been informed correctly that you have only received 16 questions a day before the committee?
Thanks, Steve. I've received the questions, most of them yesterday. I think I've got one or two today. And so I'll answer them as best I can. Some of them are quite long questions, but I don't know if one of the officers wants to clarify the procedure.
Council folks, members of the public have to submit their questions 3 days in advance. Officers obviously then look at them to see whether they fit within the criteria within the constitution for the scope of a valid question. And then obviously we would share them with the chair and with officers to assist in the preparation of answers. Clearly it's a matter for the chair as to whether or not they wish to answer the question. And obviously in some circumstances it may be considered appropriate for a written reply to be given to the member of the public rather than an answer this evening.
Thanks for that information. I think it's important that members of the public and members know the tight schedule. Certainly, I sit on the Constitution and Standards Committee. It's certainly something we can look at, maybe making it easier to get fuller answers in the future. But thanks for the information.
Perhaps I should have just added, there are timescales included in the Constitution, so it's a minute for asking the question and 2 minutes for an answer. So
I think the clue's in the title of the Constitution and Standards Committee. We can suggest changes to the Constitution.
I think that is on the work programme already.
Thank you. Stephanie, would you like to ask your question? Thank you.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay. Right, the Government Department for the Environment through the Rural Affairs, also known as DEFRA, identifies a very dangerous air pollutant associated with road traffic, known as particulate matter. This danger is expressed in this government statement. The strongest evidence for the effects on health is associated with fine particles, and they're known as PM2.5. For those unfamiliar with PM2.5, it is 30 times thinner than the human hair and can penetrate your bloodstream and even reach your brain. DEFRA has also published the following statement, and I quote, "Exposure to high concentrations of particulate matter, such as during short-term pollution episodes, can also exacerbate lung and heart conditions, significantly affecting the quality of life and increased deaths and hospital admissions. Children, the elderly, and those with predisposed respiratory and cardiovascular disease are known to be most susceptible to the health impacts of air pollution." A King's College London study published in January 2020 of the Liverpool City region identified around 180 deaths each year on Wirral from PM2.5. And at the time, the reports received publicity from the BBC and ITV. Before I say the next bit, for those unfamiliar with the word anthropogenic, It just means caused by humans. On the 26th of April this year, DEFRA stated on the internet, it is in the interest of the UK to measure concentrations of particulate matter as close to these sources of anthropogenic emissions as possible in order to effectively assess exposure to particulate matter that can be tackled via UK policies. However, Wirral Council's 2020 Air Quality Annual Status Report states that there's only one PM2.5 monitoring point in the whole of the Wirral Council area, and that is at a park in Tranmere. Wirral people need the proper measurement of PM2.5, after which community consultations, expenditures and actions can be prioritised in the interests of human health. The death of each child and the death of each adult from air pollution also reflects a deteriorating quality of life, usually over many years, and not to mention the burden on the National Health Service, a service already under extreme pressure. So my question is, why is Wirral Council not urgently undertaking regular PM2.5 monitoring at schools during drop-off and pick-up times, and also at communities adjacent to busy roads, particularly in Birkenhead, where the King's College London study identified as one of, and I quote, the most deprived and highest levels of air pollution areas in the Liverpool City region? So that's my question.
Thank you, Stephanie. I very much appreciate your question, and I'll ensure that you are updated on any work that we do to monitor PM2.5 air pollution around schools. This is a very important issue, I agree. And if we're not doing enough in this matter, then I welcome this opportunity to improve. So thank you again, Stephanie. We'll make sure you're fully updated. I also have a question from Mr. Young, who is not able to attend, and so I'll read his question for him. His question reads, can somebody in a position of responsibility please explain why there appears to be a degree of poor management and lack of consistency, even wastage, prevailing in the current borough-wide streetlight replacement programme being carried out by appointed contractors SSE Enterprise on the Council's authorisation? The following are examples to illustrate this point. On some main roads, new columns are being put in, which are the wrong height, usually smaller than they would be instead of a uniform height, whilst on others, columns with working lights have been cut down or removed prematurely, even before their replacements have been installed, leaving that specific area without illumination. There are also many locations where lights, which have already been replaced the previous year, are now being replaced. There seems to be no logic to this randomness, renewing lights again which have already been changed the previous year, or leaving out obvious broken lights on one street when the rest have been replaced. Is this not a mismanagement and waste of resources, given that I was already informed that everything is done as a matter of priority? This makes absolutely no sense. Most frustrating of all, despite repeated and exhaustive attempts to get answers to these questions, I have not had any answers over the last 18 months. With just a few weeks remaining before the onset of the darker evenings once again, and with the SSE contract drawing close to its completion, can I just plead with those officials to show a bit of common sense and rationale for once, and to focus on imminent and urgent renewal of all the logged outstanding locations? I don't have an officer response for this one, except to say that I know that the officers have already answered this question via email, so I would refer Mr. Young to the email answers that he has already received on this particular question, and if he hasn't received them, then we'll make sure that he does. But I know that the Wirral Council, I am assured repeatedly that Wirral Council never ignores a streetlight request, and if streetlights are replaced just before the new update, that's obviously a safety matter. So I myself have put in requests and seen that they have been prioritised very logically according to need. For example, a streetlight outside an area with vulnerable people, such as schools or elderly people, would take a priority over a regular streetlight. I've read through the prioritisation of streetlight repairs, and it is something that we should actually be quite proud of. And I think we should be quite proud of the rollout of the new LED lights as well. If there are any mistakes, then they're not it's not due to neglect and willful neglect. The system is seems to me to be really quite robust, but I will make sure that Mr. Young gets an emailed response, and I'm surprised that if he's not had one, I'll make inquiries as to why that is. Thank you. This now brings us to a number of questions, all on the matter of Hoylake Beach. I therefore wish to take these questions one after the other before responding, as some of the answers do contain overlapping information. So to speed up the committee meeting, we'll take each of the questions and then have an answer which hopefully addresses each of those questions. I therefore call Verity Smith to ask her question, please.
Good evening, I'm Verity Smith. The final paragraph of section 6.4 of WBC's 2010 to 2015 beach management plan, published in September 2010, says, "The appropriate assessment has to take into account the very small area of scattered spartina growth that is to be controlled and the possible long-term and major impacts that a do-nothing policy would have on the designated protected site. Using information provided by the reference Spartina Anglica, a review of its status, dynamics and management, and the fast colonisation of areas of foreshore and associated issues with this species that makes it possibly one of the most controversial species worldwide, the most obvious choice of management at Hoylake is to eradicate this species before it spreads any further. Subsequent to this publication, please can you pinpoint the exact meeting, advice or publication where it was determined that Spartina was no longer a controversial species that needed to be eradicated? Thank you.
Thank you, Verity. Can I ask Jeanette Hatter, please, to ask your question?
My question, you'll be delighted to know, is mercifully short. How many members of the committee have visited Hoylake or Mells Beach in the past 3 months? Thank you.
Thank you, Jeanette. Charlotte, are you here to ask your question?
Good evening, everybody. My name's Charlotte Smith. My question for tonight, the first one is, it has come to light that the current state of Hoylake Beach is having a detrimental effect or impact on the operations of the emergency services, and therefore potentially putting lives at risk. The accumulation of sand, for example, near King's Gap, Slipway and beyond, is an example of this. With this in mind, will the committee make provisions to rake and maintain the amenity beach between King's Gap and the new lifeboat station to allow easy access to the emergency services? Basic legislative principles can be found under the Coast Guard Act of 1925, and local authorities do have the power to provide such provisions under Section 234 of the Public Health Act 1936. And I also have a supplementary question.
You can ask that now, yes, go on.
Thank you. Please can you advise of the list of stakeholders in regard to the beach and why you appear to be whitewashing them by referring them to an email inbox when we know that the environmental chair has a very poor record of engagement and rarely responds to inquiries pertaining to Hoylake Beach, except to refer to the Have Your Say email website inbox, which is now debunked as no one hardly ever received a response from that as well. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Charlotte. And this brings us on to Miles. Do we have Miles present to ask a question? Thank you.
Good evening. My question is, why is the survey of Hoylake Beach
taking so long that by the time it reports, the beach will be beyond reclamation. Short one.
Very welcome, yes. Thank you very much. Thank you, Miles.
I do have a supplementary, if I'm allowed it.
If you want to ask that now, yes.
It's a short one too.
That has to be short too. Thank you.
Will the Whillick Beach Scientific Survey consider that dried mud has encouraged grass and spartina as a result of regular dredging of both the Mersey and Mostyn Port approach?
Thank you, Miles. Joanne, are you present to ask your question?
My name's Joanne Randalls. On the 21st of November 2019, I emailed yourself, Councillor Elizabeth Gray, regarding my concerns about excessive amounts of grass growing on Hoylake and Mells foreshores. In your reply, you quoted to me, "The grass is almost meadow grass, not spartina." Today, the entire length of Mells Promenade from the Hoylake RNLI station to Dove Point is excessively covered with spartina growth, and all within 2 years. And it is continuing to spread unchecked in a northeasterly direction towards Moreton Shore. My question is, what considerations were made by the Cabinet Member for the Environment 2 years ago, the Environmental Committee since, and the officers produced advice on the implications of letting spartina spread unchecked with the possibility of spartina spreading along the entire northern Wirral coastline and the likely impact it might have on the established wildlife of this coastline? I did enclose photographs of which were taken in the last fortnight.
Thank you very much for your question. Julie, do we have a Julie present for her question?
Hello, I'm Julie Hunter. Question. The Wirral is surrounded on three sides by 25 miles of coast. Sections are assigned special international, European and UK protected site status. This means the Council has a complex management task, and actions taken or not taken within these designated areas could have long-term and far-reaching implications and repercussions. Scanning the horizon of our shores, I easily identify several hazards which need to be managed to protect this environment and its local communities for the future. Can you give assurances that the Council is preparing a transparent coastal management plan to help keep coastal communities safe, healthy, and happy, and that it will incorporate some of the unexpected, relevant new science which is emerging now in the light of the COP26, which would help to future-proof the plan?
Thank you for your question.
Am I allowed a second?
If it's very, very short, obviously.
I'll do it quick. Okay. Will the Council consider pursuing a sandscape coastal defence project with Royal Haskoning? Because when I scan the beach horizon, I see a climate crisis hazard. Out of control, salt marsh grass, recently shown as emitting more CO2 than it stores, and even worse, emitting methane, a greenhouse gas 80 times more potent than CO2 over a 20-year period. Marsh gas methane would be a climate disaster.
Thank you for the question. Wendy, are you here with your question, please?
Thank you very much. My name is Wendy Bennett. I've lived in Hoylake for 60 years. And I also represent a local beach group called Friends of Hoylake and West Kirby Beaches. My question is the council planning to consult and meet with bona fide groups in Hoylake as part of their beach management consultation? And if so, which groups and when will those meetings be?
Thank you, Wendy, for your question. Do we have Joe here with his question? Thank you.
Councillors, on the part of the council website dedicated to the Hoylake Beach Management, why is it not possible for contributors to ask questions and receive answers relating to the Hoylake and West Kirby beaches, whereas on the rest of the website, this is possible? May I just add a small supplementary? The reason I mention this is the feeling in Hoylake and West Kirby of neglect of the local people. Since the pandemic...
Sorry, can I just interrupt? Is this a statement or a question? Because we're allowed supplementary questions, but not statements. So is it a question?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, since the pandemic, I've met many people from beyond Hoylake, West Kirby, even the Wirral, who've come to the beach. People from Cheshire and even I met two people from Manchester, and they said, coming to the Wirral is like going on holiday. Why can't you clear this beach? Everyone is growing great frustration in Hoylake and West Kirby and beyond.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Neil, do we have Neil with his question? Thank you.
Hello, good evening, everybody. Please, could you describe the education and training that environmental officers and committee members receive to ensure that they are up to date with the latest guidance and thinking and can therefore provide accurate answers post them through the Have Your Say portal? Also, please also share the sources of the information used to provide this education and training. May I have a supplementary as well, please, Chair?
As long as it is a question, I'll
It is a question, Thank you. Could I ask the committee, when the grass from Hoylake and Mells spreads as it is spreading along the beach to Leeso and New Brighton, will you as a committee take the same approach to those beaches as you are doing to Hoylake and Mells beaches? And if you aren't going to take the same approach, can you please tell us why you aren't doing nothing on that, or why you're not going to do anything there? Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. Thanks. Do we have Caroline with her question?
Sorry. Good evening. My question to the council members is, we've reached a 2-year anniversary of the cessation of the beach management plan. This was required to consider both conservation and the needs of the residents. Councillor Elizabeth Gray, you've previously advised residents that a compromise could be negotiated with Natural England to rake a section of the beach from the RNI NLI station to the old toilet block, but more preferable would be to King's Gap. Given the time lapsed and the detrimental effects on the community, will the council give urgent consideration for this compromise to be negotiated and approved by Natural England before the damage is irreparable? This is so the community and tourists can enjoy some sandy beach amenity area once again, as afforded to New Brighton and West Kirby. Thank you.
Thank you. Nicola, are you here to ask your question?
Thank you. Good evening, everybody. I'm a self-employed business owner based in Hoylake, running a short-term letting company in the corporate and holiday letting industry. We have obviously been severely affected by the pandemic and are desperately trying to recover and build our business going forward. The current disgraceful and unmaintained state of Hoylake Beach has and is, in my opinion, having a direct negative effect on my business and other businesses locally. As visitors are no longer coming, there's no usable clean beach for them to use, footfall is down significantly, and with less people and less money being spent in Hoylake, the economic impact is obvious. My guests, some of whom have visited and stayed with me for over 20 years now, are shocked and horrified by the current state of the beach, and I cannot justify the council's actions to them when they say how beautiful it once was and yet how sad and neglected it currently is. We as residents and business owners expected our council to support us post-pandemic, and we feel incredibly let down and dismissed as our demands for a clean, raked, usable beach are continually ignored. I would like to ask this council committee, what assurances can you give me and other Hoylake business owners today that we are being heard and that there are plans to clear an amenity beach area and that it is imminent? As any plans to delay this for another 12 to 18 months at least will be disastrous and potentially fatal to both my business and other lots of other local businesses, and Hoylake's economy may never recover. Thank you.
Thank you for your question. Kevin, are you here with your question? Do we have anybody? Do we have Kevin with a question?
The question from Calvin Rice is, Spartina is a pioneer salt marsh species which is rapidly spreading in Hoylake and Mells. Salt marsh is considered as a sink for global warming and causing carbon. However, recent research published in April 2021 has established that half of the global methane emissions come from aquatic ecosystems, including salt marsh conditions. My question is, given the above, in respect of the post-study findings and following the independent evaluations on Hoylake Beach, what are the hopes and the aims of the council on receipt of the evidence?
Thank you for that. And that brings us to the end of the Hoylake Beach questions. Thank you all for these questions. It is important to direct you to the Have Your Say Beach portal, and the reason for that is that that is where we are constantly updating the data as it comes in. So that's where the latest information regarding the scientific findings, but also regarding the law, are to be found. So you can find the Natural England guidance for Wirral Council, setting out the parameters of what we legally can and cannot do on Hoylake Beach. You can find that on the Have Your Say portal, which is available through the council website. It is important, and that's why people direct you to that portal. That is where the consultation will be held. In the meantime, people can leave comments. But at the moment, it is for information and it is for leaving of comments. The consultation stage is yet to start. It is most important that you do place and leave your comments there. Many of these questions have clear answers that you will find in that portal if you look through that information. If the public want to find answers to any of the questions that have been asked tonight, they can look at the portal and they will find the answers to those questions. It's important to note that the Natural England advice has been updated considerably. So one questioner referred to the advice that we were given in 2010. So that's over a decade ago, and the advice from Natural England has changed dramatically in that time. We cannot follow out-of-date information and out-of-date advice. The permissions that were given in the past would not be given now, and Natural England have assured us of that. If you read the information in the portal, you will see that. We must legally follow Natural England advice at all times. And as the climate and environment emergencies have unfolded, their advice has increasingly been to protect and promote the natural world. I note that I have been quoted out of context regarding grass on the beach, and this can be corrected in writing later. I visit the beach regularly. I can answer that question personally. It's one of my favourite places. I cannot speak for the rest of the committee, and I'm not prepared to ask them what they do in their free time, but they may wish to get in touch with you, and your contact details are obviously available. We have not been notified by any emergency services of any obstacle to their operations at all. I can assure you that all Wirral beaches are treated the same. None has been raked since 2019, and the fact that others are grass-free is due to natural processes. Spartina anglica has environmental benefits. For example, it can trap sand sediment, helping other salt marsh plants to colonise. Spartina, interspersed with other salt marsh species, can provide habitats for invertebrates and therefore create suitable feeding grounds for waders and water birds. The RSPB has a number of times approved our current approach to Hoylake Beach. Emerging evidence is showing that Spartina anglica is not dominating the vegetation and reducing in frequency as the beach changes and other plants become established. The coastal environment is dynamic and subject to natural change. Allowing habitats to respond naturally and establish can help to stabilise beach sediment, making them less prone to coastal erosion, effectively acting as a natural sea defence when sea levels are bound to rise. Wirral Council is in discussion with the RNLI as to the exact nature of any issues that they might notice on the slipways. Key stakeholders are those with a regulatory function with regard to the area, such as Natural England, the Environment Agency, and the Marine Management Organisation. The communication and engagement strategy approved by this committee on the 16th of March 2021 sets out that the first phase of consultation, which will start after the publication of the geomorphology and ecology study, will seek a wide range of views from both key stakeholders and other stakeholders, that is, anyone with an interest in the beach. Wirral Council will then consider all stakeholder interests and, subject to further consultation, develop an appropriate and legally compliant management plan. The process and timescales for the development of a beach management plan for Hoylake are set out in the communications and engagement strategy approved by this committee. It's also referenced on the Hoylake Beach information Have Your Say portal. The discretionary advice received from Natural England in March 2020 states that as habitats form naturally in new locations with the statutory designated, within the statutory designated sites, they will be considered as conservation features of the statutory designated site and will therefore be covered by the site's conservation objectives. For example, developing pioneer salt marsh and sand dunes on the North Wirral foreshore are protected as features of the D-estuary special area of conservation. The Council takes a strategic approach to managing flood and coastal erosion risk and is in turn given direction by the Environment Agency's National Flood and Coastal Erosion Risk Management Strategy. And I believe that answers as many of the questions as I was able to do given the time that I had to do that. I would like to thank you. I appreciate that you have got serious concerns about this. There are, believe me, an equal number of people on the other side with serious concerns that we haven't been doing enough to protect nature. And it's important that you all have your say. So as a last thing, I will direct you and any residents watching to the Have Your Say portal and have your say. Thank you very much.
For the interests of members of the public, I regularly visit the beach, find it the diversity across that coast very interesting.
I was actually there today and I was quite surprised at the amount of people I saw on the beach. I saw people walking their dogs on the said grass. I saw families with preschool children further along on the sand. I spoke to an elderly couple that lived in Lake Road or Lake Drive, I'm not sure, that tell me they've been enjoying watching the wildlife, so we do regularly visit the beach and take note.
If we're just all chiming in, I'm happy to say I visit the beach regularly. I just would like to know, when you reference, Chair, the other side, are there sides in this debate? I'm sorry, everybody here has concerns about this beach, but they may well have also concerns about climate change. Don't pitch sides. You reference people as the other side.
Cameron, I'd appreciate if you just, with the spirit that was intended, this has been quite a polarised debate in terms of those who want raking of the beach and those who don't. I wasn't mentioning any other environmental concerns.
Some people want raking of some of the beach, so the other side is inappropriate.
Sorry, Councillor Cameron, this is not open for debate. This is public questions.
You didn't shut down your other colleagues.
Councillor Cameron, they were answering one of the questions that was put to them.
You didn't invite them to answer.
You didn't ask. Would anybody else like to say whether or not they've visited Hoylake Beach in the last 3 months?
I visited the beach on Friday, and I think the beach is not a beach. It's a disgrace. I've heard your statement about we have to follow Natural England or whatever it is. Can you tell me, is there any reason today why we can't rake some of that beach?
We don't have legal permission from Natural England to do so.
Can we obtain permission then?
They've asked us to do geomorphological and ecological studies first, and that's what we're doing. Thank you very much for the public questions. There will be no more questions from the public. This now brings us on to 5.2, statements and petitions. And no statements or petitions have been received. However, I do have a very brief statement to make myself that also involves a gift for committee members. I won't take up too much time, so please do bear with me. It is a shame that when the public ask questions, they can't all behave themselves.
Don't lecture the public.
So as I said, I'm aware that, as has already been suggested in the questions, we are not moving far enough or fast enough on the climate and the biodiversity crises. And this is deeply frustrating. In many cases, it is not down to lack of political will. And I believe that when we declared an environment and climate emergency in July 2019, it was heartfelt for most of us. That when Councillor Braham quoted Greta Thunberg, he really meant it. And when Tony Norbury referred to the critical choices we face regarding a habitable or uninhabitable planet of the future, that was also from the heart. I know that when I said we needed to learn from the war generation on how to live within our means, or rather within our planetary boundaries, I certainly hoped we would have achieved more than we have right now as a council, as a country, and as an international community. In July 2019, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change had at that point said we had a decade to sort things out before they became irreversible and catastrophic. They have recently declared that humanity is on red alert, code red for humanity. The Intergovernmental Panel on Biological Diversity and Ecosystem Services has also said that time is running out to stop a mass extinction all around us, both climate change and biodiversity loss devastating life on Earth. I know how hard our officers have been working on this and just how committed most of them are. But this is something for us to be thinking about now. Apologies. This is something for us to be thinking about now. We should be rightly proud of what we have done as a council, but we need to do more. We are the ones, as elected members, who need to give a steer on policies. At this critical juncture,
should we take a little break?
At this critical juncture, as we head towards COP15 and COP26, are we going to guide the council to do the right thing in transport and environment policies or not? Are we going to make the difficult decisions and explain to our residents why we must make sacrifices in our daily lives now to ensure that our children and grandchildren have a recognisable, safe, and viable planet on which to live in the not-too-distant future? COP15 on biodiversity is still going ahead soon, though fragmented and online at first. COP26 on climate change is still being planned, and each of these conferences needs to make radical promises for all our sakes. Our governments then need to act. We can't save the world just from this committee, but we absolutely must do everything within our power. We have a variety of really, really experienced councillors around the table here in all parties, bringing all kinds of life experience and understanding to this committee. And we need to harness that and work together. Remind me if I get political. I'm just as prone as everybody else to party politics. And I urge you and your parties not to use the environment for any political campaigns. It's just too big. The question regarding our carbon literacy was spot on. If we are to avoid partisan positioning and petty campaigning, and if we are to really work together to address the biodiversity crisis and the climate crisis, then we will need to be fully informed and up to date on the facts about these problems. And we need to address them here in Wirral. We will need that carbon literacy training. And I commend each of the councillors and officers that has already given up precious free time to attend the training. I know that others are signed up and to the next round, and we will become a carbon literate organisation. In preparation for COP15 and COP26, I have been reading and rereading some key books, and one of the very best is David Attenborough's latest book on his life and his work, charting the increasing problems of habitat loss and climate change. I would be grateful if members would accept as a small gift from me a copy of this book, which I will also give to the Chief Exec and the Leader of the Council. I do have alternatives for those of you who have read it already, as I know you are interested in this. I did think possibly about resigning in protest, that we are just not getting enough done. But I know I'm not significant enough for that to have much impact or achieve anything. So I do hope that you can accept this gift in the spirit it is intended, read and work together to move further and faster in response to the devastating environmental problems we all face. Thank you. I'll give out the books now so we can have that break. Thank you.
Chair, I wonder, could I just make a brief response to your statement before? We've got some feedback, I think. I'd just like to thank you for the very generous gifts that you've given to us all. Councillor Cook has already criticised me for not having read the book already, but I certainly shall do now. And I would certainly like to pick up the comment made about the training, the climate crisis training that we've all been offered. I have taken part in it, and if other members haven't yet, I certainly would commend it to you. It is essential, I think, that we all educate ourselves as far as we can to grapple with this emergency. I think when people look at the constant round of news, week after week, there's another natural disaster somewhere, floods, fires, storms, and these coming with increasing regularity, we have to realise that there's something happening in this world which we are at the last chance saloon. If as a world we cannot work together and change the impact that we are having as human beings on our environment, then we don't have much future as a human race. And I think it's a frustration to all of us that we have limited element of power and control as councillors, but I think it's essential that we don't just have workshops and seminars and discussions, that we actually translate those into action. And we do need a sense of urgency when we're grappling with the issues that come to this committee. And so I'd just like to conclude again by thanking you for your remarks and for the gifts that you've given us.
Thank you, Councillor Bray. I really appreciate that. Yes.
Chair, thank you. I'd like to echo Alan's words. Thank you very much for the gift, and I will read it. And no one can doubt your passion for the subject. And it's a hard listen. But with all these, please don't think that people on this side of the committee don't equally believe in what is happening to this world and want to change it, because we do. I was in council many years ago when Councillor Fowkes, because of his background, because of where he came from, because of his beliefs, sat opposite me and said, "I hate all Tories." And he meant it. And I don't hold it against him. It's his beliefs. And I'm not keen on what he believes in, but at the end of the day, we want to get to the end result. We both want the world to be a better place. We go about it slightly differently. And there has to be a balance in everything that we do. And I think that sometimes, if you are so passionate about something, it can become overriding. We try and put some balance, hence there's a committee and we all have our opinions. But please don't take it as a personal spite that we're all against, because we're not. But we will do things our way.
Thank you, Councillor Matney. Just to reassure you, I wasn't taking it as a personal slight, and I didn't assume that anybody on any side of this table had any stronger feelings about the environmental emergencies than anybody else. That was anything references I made to politics was to all parties, including my own and including myself. Thank you. Councillor
Chair,
Fox.
Sorry, but he did. He fell into the trap of naming names. I can't remember that statement. If I did, I don't hate anybody. I'm a good Christian lad. And just to lighten the place up a little bit, the last book I read was The History of Glue. I couldn't put it down. Okay.
Thank you very much. That was much needed. I think we have a member's question. Is that right?
Yes, sorry, I couldn't submit this in advance, Chair, because I'm deputising. It just cropped up. There's a couple of my colleagues, in the same group. One works at Clatterbridge Cancer Centre and one works at Liverpool University. They're finding the carbon literacy courses, daytime options, very, very difficult. They are keen to take part in the course, but naturally, as you appreciate, with their career, that's difficult. There was some talk of evening courses, and I think they clashed with committee dates, and we have a very busy schedule of committee dates. So I'd just like to see some more options around courses, if officers could help me. Thank you.
Yes. Mike, could you answer that, please?
Yeah, that's correct. We attempted to get some evening courses to happen, but the clash with committee. So we've gone back to APSE. We're going to carry that course on the rest of this municipal year, and we're going to shape it around evenings and weekends. There's been a slight reduction in the amount of hours or time, so we think we can do it in two sessions, which means it can be done in 1 week or one weekend. We'll put those offers to members. And just to add that by the end of this month, we'll have around 140 people through the course, senior members, the most senior members, and most senior officers in the council attending courses next week, or the week after, sorry.
Thanks for taking the question.
That's great. Thank you very much. This takes us on to... Councillor Cook, sorry, my apologies.
No, it's all right. I don't want to signal my own virtue for thanking you for the other book that you gave those of us who'd already read the David Attenborough book. Thanks for the overstory, by the way. I'll enjoy reading that. And I'd just like also to say how relieved I was and when I heard that, although you considered resigning as a protest from the chair, I'm glad you didn't, because I think you did an extremely good job, you know, very efficiently. And there was something else I was going to say in response to people on the other side. I don't want to be hugely confrontational at this stage, but, you know, when Conservatives say they have their own way of doing the environment and so on, why is it that in the areas, in a local council context, where we do have some influence in things like, you know, reducing speed limits, that, you know, and car parking charges, they all sound quite trivial and parochial, but these are the modest ways which cumulatively, if there is such a word, we can all do together, which do have a huge environmental impact, at least worldwide, you know. And where we've put these things forward, they've been knocked back by the Tories. You know, they didn't want the car parking charges increases, extension, and they don't really want the 20-mile-an-hour speed limits, you know, which is geared to getting people into active travel, you know. So I'd like to hear from the Conservative side what they would propose that we do as a council to actually tackle, you know, the climate emergency. Thank you.
Can I respond to that?
Actually, the last
it's not a direct statement. It's the last time
we
were at committee.
Can we keep it really brief? Because we really do need to move on.
The last time we were at committee, I thought the targets reported to us by officers that we were 35% ahead of schedule or something. So that's what this committee is doing.
Thank you, and thank you, Councillor Cook. I'd like to now move on to item 6, which is the road safety programme update. And this can be found on pages 11 to pages 280 of the agenda. And I'd like to invite Simon Fox to present the report. Simon, thank you for waiting. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. So, Chair, this report is a position update following the report to your committee on the 16th of March this year. And the report sets out some of the progress against the Road Safety Working Group recommendations passed by that committee, as well as progress against our 2021 to 22 local safety schemes in the Combined Authority Transport Plan programme that was also approved at that meeting. But it is not a comprehensive proposed forward programme of work. This will be brought to a subsequent meeting of your committee early in 2022. Recently, we have been able to submit a funding application to the Liverpool City Region Sustainable Transport Settlement, which includes bids for a number of road safety-related projects and initiatives, including the borough-wide 20-mile-per-hour residential speed limit, which was a resolution of your committee in March, as well as bids to convert light segregation active travel projects into more robust and permanently engineered segregation, and a wide-ranging speed limit review on our main classified roads. The report that we will bring to your committee early next year will include a full schedule of locations where road safety interventions have been requested by petitioners, some of them at this committee, ward members, the public, and together with evidential data, officers' assessments, evaluations, and recommendations for interventions and their prioritisation, set against the available five-year budget allocation, with a proposed programme for your consideration commencing in 2022 to 23. So in commending this update report to you, I would like to highlight some of the other key achievements against the 32 recommendations of the Road Safety Working Group that were approved in March. And some of these are that we've made road safety and Vision Zero a key theme of the recently agreed community safety strategy. We've worked with members, communities and partner organisations to help address local concerns, for example, at Spittal and in Eastham. We've progressed with an initial 6 pilot schemes for school streets projects, and we're aiming to implement the first of these schemes at Greenlees Primary School in Wallasey, Christchurch Primary School in Birkenhead, and Liscard Primary School in Liscard later on this year. Additionally, colleagues in Regeneration and Place Directorates are taking a report to the Economy, Regeneration and Development Committee on the 29th of September, seeking approval for officers to work with Sustrans, the Liverpool City Region Combined Authority and the local stakeholders to co-develop and design a livable neighbourhood in Bebbington. We've delivered a comprehensive programme of educational training and awareness raising campaigns in very challenging circumstances during the pandemic with schools and various road user groups and identified funding to support these. We've introduced vehicle-activated speed warning signs at many locations around the borough, including those that highlight the actual speed the vehicles are travelling at with a slowdown or thank you message, and some of the examples of those can be seen in Port Sunlight and Spittal. And we are progressing with internal restructures as part of the neighbourhood service review in order to provide the necessary staffing resilience to help deliver the working group recommendations. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Simon. I appreciate it. I know how much work is going into this, and I do appreciate it. Does anybody, before I say anything, has anybody got any questions?
Thank you, Chair. Thanks. Just you referenced Spittal, which is obviously one of the newer things. I was wondering if we had any indication that people's speed has reduced approaching with the intervention that you put in, but it's very early days. But that's interfering. One of the schemes that predates all of the list that you just gave, I think, was the diagonal crossing. So given that that was put in quite a way before the pandemic, did we have some pre and post data to compare with that's even prior to lockdown, so we can see how that diagonal crossing helped at that particular crossroads?
Yes, we will have data on the Upton diagonal crossing scheme. Obviously, that was introduced in, you know, based on statistics that were applying at the time, and we will have data that, you know, whether that's made a difference. In terms of Spittal, as you're aware, we are going to commission a full feasibility study. We've already done the road repairs, the surfacing patching, the white line refreshing, and the vehicle activated sign, which I'm sure anecdotally has made a difference. I mean, I visibly see people slowing down when it flashes up at them, so hopefully it is already having an effect. The feasibility study will take some time to conclude, and the surveys we've decided to start as of next week, so that will be able to give us a more realistic picture in terms of the traffic volumes now once schools have had at least a week back. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. Councillor Brame.
Thank you, Chair, and again, thank you, Simon, for this very detailed report. A few specific questions, first of all. On 412 in the paragraph about the Safer Road Watch, do we know how many volunteers we currently have on Wirral who are taking part in that? It does seem an initiative which we might well want to encourage more people to be involved in. And then in 419, there's the reference to mode shift and the statement that schools are required to create an action plan. Required sounds a strong word, but it's a good one. Does that apply to academies too? And in fact, you know, are schools buying into this this project? On the vehicle activated signs that Councillor Cameron was referring to, can you tell us what is the cost of these? Obviously, I was going to ask about the impact of these, and you obviously said we're going to be looking at the data on that. But it'd be good to know, you know, are these value for money? They seem to me to be subjectively very potentially very effective So perhaps we could roll more of those out. I'd make a comment that, that there's a reference to the Merseyside Local Transport Plan 3 and the criteria that are spelt out on that for traffic interventions. And there's one in there which says to improve the quality of life. And when we're assessing the need for traffic intervention, we're always looking, quite rightly, at the accident record in particular locations and what we can do to mitigate that and to eradicate it and move towards that vision zero that we all want. But I would maintain that the purpose of reducing traffic volumes and reducing traffic speed is not simply a matter of safety, but it is, as it says in that criterion, a matter of improving the quality of life. So I think we need to think, you know, that's one of the driving factors and one of the reasons that many of us are keen to roll out this 20-mile-per-hour limit on our residential roads. It's partly for safety, but it's also to make them more pleasant, more livable environments. And we're responding to the demand we're getting from residents in many of our residential roads. I'm pleased to hear that, you know, we're looking to get a further report sort of next year about how this is going to be taken forward. But I would just say that there are a number of authorities already in the country, some of the London boroughs, Portsmouth, for example, where they have instigated borough-wide 20-mile-per-hour limits on the residential roads. I would think, you know, that's a model that we could aspire to. I think some of us have a great sense of impatience. Obviously, we want to move faster, perhaps, than is probably practical. But we do feel there is a sense of urgency about this. So I would hope that we can, looking forward to that report when it comes, but we're looking forward to really pushing that on as speedily as we can. Thank you.
Thanks, Alan. Chris?
Yes, I appreciate your comments there, Councillor Brain. They certainly are in the spirit of, you know, the outcome, the conclusions that we came to in the process of our working groups several months ago now. I think it was last year, wasn't it, when we got together and arrived at, you know, a broad consensus about how we should go forward with really pressing hard for a 20-mile-an-hour speed limits borough-wide and so on. And I'm just going to refer to the minutes of the March the 16th meeting, which is getting on for 6 months ago now, which were reported in the June the 14th committee, where Councillor Brain, seconded by myself, put forward this motion, which got through with a comfortable majority. I'm just going to read it out again, just to remind everybody, officers and other members, you know, how strongly we felt about not just having widespread 20-mile-an-hour speed zones in the borough, because we already have those, you know, and that's what the report seems to be saying, that we're going to have widespread 20-mile-an-hour speed limits in residential areas and so on. And then the report harks back to 2012, when the borough was divided up into 130 zones, and about 12, it says about approximately 12 of those, why not exactly 12? You know, because if you put approximately about a number which was determined about 9 years ago, it suggests that it's a bit sort of half-hearted, you know, so let's be precise about that. But it's less than 10% of the borough was divided up and given 20-mile-an-hour speed limits, and to be honest, that's caused no end of confusion and resentment, even within one ward, because in my ward, Prenton, the residents in the not-so-well-off areas who say, why is it we've got this traffic here, we've got no 20-mile-an-hour speed limits up, and the other side of the ward, the better-off ward, it's 20 miles an hour everywhere. You know, how socially just is that? And this has been going on for 9 years. So we've really got to roll this out, not just make it more widespread. Yeah, borough-wide means practically everywhere in residential areas, yeah? Now, Councillor Brain's motion, I'll just read it briefly, It says, the committee recognises that a lower speed limit will help reduce the actual and perceived danger on the streets and take a step towards reclaiming the streets as a social place where neighbours interact with each other and encourage more children to walk or cycle to school. Slower traffic speeds can enable the elderly to travel independently and safely. Accordingly, officers are requested to prepare a scheme to make Wirral a 20 miles an hour borough. And that means everywhere, you know, where it's practicable. Residential roads should be designated as 20 mile an hour limit areas with signage and road markings alone, except in isolated cases where traffic calming measures might be necessary, where it's the average speed, the mean speed, is over 24 miles an hour. That's something that the report, the council report, doesn't make it clear. It suggests that if the mean speed of a road is above 24 miles an hour, you can't do it. But that's not true. That's a misrepresentation of even government documents from the Ministry of Transport. Okay. So, you know, it was as strong as that. And yet when we read the report now about road safety, there isn't a recognition of that. So my worry is that we've got councils getting together, voting by majority to implement something, you know, seriously, and reports are coming back, watering it down every time, and it's just not democratic, you know. There is political will to get this moving, and it's just not happening as fast as it should be, or the suggestion is that it might not be at all, you know. It's only basically where residents want it, or so. You know, we've got to get this moving. I'll leave it there. I don't usually sort that long. Apologies.
Thank you, Chris. Do you want to get back to that, Simon? Thanks.
Thanks, Chair. I'll pick up on a few of Councillor Brame's questions and Councillor Cook's as well. Safer road watch schemes. We do have safer road watch schemes, and we have implemented safer road watch schemes. I'll give you the information, if that's okay, separately about where those operate. And it is an option, and I discussed with Eastern Ward councillors recently that, you know, that's an option for them. There's a concern from community groups within Eastern Village about speed of traffic through there. It's not always easy to get residents to volunteer for these schemes. It's quite a commitment from them, but we have got good links with Merseyside Police, and I think on the workshops, I think you were part of earlier on this year, you know, Merseyside Police said they enjoy working with Wirral. That, you know, Wirral are very proactive in this field, so, you know, we want to continue with that, and we strongly believe that that type of scheme is very effective in reducing speed, so I agree with that. Mode shift within schools, I think, is a fairly recent thing. I need to check for you again, and I will let you know about whether it's applicable to academy schools as well, but it's fairly new. In terms of vehicle-activated signs and the flashing signs, you're right, they do seem to be effective. Cost-wise, in themselves, they're not massively costly, but we feel that we need to be cautious about putting too many up, because it will reduce the effectiveness. People take them for granted and ignore them, you know, whereas if there's a few and we move them around, so we're more inclined to put sockets for them on lighting columns at each arm of a junction, say, like we're going to do at Spittle, and then move it round so that it's not just in one location each time. We feel that will have more effect rather than just having multiple sites. You mentioned about LTP3 saying it was about quality of life as well as reducing casualty statistics, and that's right. And, you know, this is what the school streets projects are about, the low traffic neighbourhoods and the 20 mile an hour borough. And that brings me on to Councillor Cook's question, which is, I think, a frustration about the speed of progress with 20 mile an hour zones. And, you know, what I would say is that, you know, we brought a report in March which sets out how we were going to spend 1.2 million of Command Authority Transport Plan budget, that we had to cover all of our active travel and road safety infrastructure for the whole year, and that was obviously passed in a separate report of that committee. And it was at that same committee where the resolution to move to 20 mile an hour in all residential, and I think the word is just other areas as well, off yeah, areas was passed. So we are where we are with the budget's available, and what we've said is we have made a bid as part of the 5-year programme now through the city region to get funding for that, and we'll move on with it next year. Obviously, you know, these 20-mile-an-hour limits will be subject to consultation through TRO processes. You know, so there is the opportunity for people to comment and be consulted. But we are pressing on with that programme and we'll bring that report next year. Thank you, Chair.
Thanks, Simon. Sorry, I noticed that Helen had her hand up before.
Yeah, it's just a quick one, really, around there's a traffic calming process you've put in place on Manor Drive. You've put a couple of islands in, and it's an absolutely perfect solution. But unfortunately, due to driver error, it's not helping the situation. So in the last month, there's been 6 accidents in that little stretch. So I'm just being mindful that, you know, schemes can be put in place and with the best intentions. But unfortunately, what's happening is the drivers do not know how to act when they come up there, and then bollards are being knocked down. There's less light because the bollards aren't there. It's just been a nightmare, even though the intention was, you know, to support traffic calming. And one final thing. You know, on motorways, you can get variable speed cameras. Is there ever been something like that on A road or a B road, or is that something that needs to come in the future?
Thank you, Chair. So in relation to Manor Drive, I actually went and had a look at it just before I came to committee tonight because I wondered whether it might come up. So, yes, it was. That was a specific road safety intervention measure that was paid for by the developer contribution from the residential development. With the best will in the world, it is quite a radical solution for a straight road like that, but it's not unusual. You know, we do have these give and take chicanes, and they are around the country in other places as well. What we have done is we've replaced the bollards with the bright yellow, very, very reflectorized bollards that we're now using on all our junctions, and are massively better visibility, and we hope that will address the concerns with accidents. But we are reviewing it, and with any engineering design and installation that we put on the highway network, we have to go through a design, a construct, and a safety audit post-construction. So that's what we're doing, and we've made those changes with the bollards. I think we're doing better illumination on the signage, and hopefully people get used to it and slow down as a result. In terms of your question about variable speed limit cameras, yes, they can be used on A roads as well as motorways. Normally, when you see them on motorways, obviously it's through roadworks, but they can be used as a traffic calming measure on A roads. But those types of speed cameras and the fixed box speed cameras need to follow very strict criteria with the police. And there's a road camera safety partnership board across Merseyside that needs to approve locations where they can be installed. So it's quite strict criteria to get them installed. Thank you, Chair.
Thanks, Simon. Councillor Cameron.
Thanks, Chair. I'm just reading about the communication and marketing, and obviously it's a key part, and it references behavioural science to inform the messages. The messaging campaign, the messages campaign, but anyway, behavioural science. I'd be really keen to see if you can share that behavioural science, particularly where there's been success, or particularly in this country, because I've seen lots of nudge theories and lots of case studies from external to this country. But in particular, Merseyside, the statistics have always been, in my lifetime, the statistics have been horrible for Merseyside. So if there's anything really hyper-local, that would be great. But even UK-wide, you know, broader than nudge theory, and you could share that would be great.
Yes, we'll do that, Chair. Thank you.
That's great. Thanks, Simon, because that would be really interesting. Go on, Councillor Collins, sorry.
Thanks, Chair. Just a couple of things. Pensby was one of the pilot areas for the 20-mile-an-hour zones. I'd actually like to know some information about whether there has been a reduction in casualties, which we all want to see. So I'd like to know some information about that. I actually spent some time with the police speed camera unit, a group of specials who do a fantastic job, on Fisher's Lane, and we had cars going down there, and the speeds ranged from 25 to 45 miles an hour. those who were at excessive speeds actually were spoken to by the police, and they had a piece of paper when they finished with them. But the majority were between 30 and 35 miles an hour. That's in a 30-mile-an-hour zone. And I've had residents say to me, it doesn't matter those 20-mile-an-hour signs. They don't do anything. Is there anything we can actually do to actually, I think it's part of the marketing, is to actually get drivers to actually slow down in those areas that we've already got designated as 20-mile-an-hour? I've seen speeds, and it's been horrendous. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Councillor Collins. Simon, are you able to answer that one?
Thanks, Chair. It is very difficult, and obviously it comes down to enforcement and police resources, and they will always admit that, you know, they've got limited resources like everyone else, but they do work closely with us and do those campaigns, as you've witnessed. And I think the Community Speed Watch campaign as well, if residents are willing to sign up to that, is a good way forward as well. Thanks. Thank you, Chair.
Thanks, Simon. Does anybody else have a question? Sorry, Councillor Williams.
Thanks, Chair. I just wanted to ask, I was pleased to hear that a couple of VAS signs were put up and put sunlight near to Belton Road. But one of the residents had told me that one had actually come down, been knocked down, and they thought it was maybe put too low and could it be put a bit higher. But it was a couple of weeks ago and I haven't heard. Do you know anything whether that's been put back?
Yes, I am aware of that. We don't know whether it's been damaged by a vehicle or whether it's been vandalised, but we are seeking a replacement and probably going to mount it at a different height.
Thank you. Chris?
Yeah, we've just heard comments about difficulties relating to specific schemes, pilot schemes, you know, and everything else dotted around the Wirral. But I already sort of alluded to the fact that there's confusion about this whole business about, you know, speeds in the borough. And I think it's very good. Just look into the psychology of a motorist who's a bit self-centred, you know, and they find themselves speeding at 30 miles an hour and get stopped. And they're told, that was 20 miles an hour. I said, well, you know, a couple of roads down out of the area, it was 30 miles an hour, and I couldn't see any difference in terms of road safety and everything else. So there's always that idea that on the whole it's 30 miles an hour, and just the odd little place in there it's 20 miles an hour. You know, so the way to solve your problem is to create a total change in culture whereby, you know, it's 20 miles an hour virtually everywhere. So that's the rule rather than exception. And I've also read in the Department for Transport and the DVLA and so on how the new driving tests are moving this way, so that you know, learner drivers are being taught, you know, hopefully up and down the country, that the default speed, they should be assuming it's going to be 20 miles an hour. So are we going to be behind in that sort of general movement across the country? You know, are we going to be one of the last boroughs to sort of finally accept that that's the way it's going to go, not just for climate change, but, you know, for livable neighbourhoods and everything else, you know? Because, as I say, dotted around the place, then there are all the excuses in the world for people to not comply, you see, and I don't believe that the majority of people will speed it and get away with it without police enforcement. I believe that the majority of people follow the lead, you know, and if most people are doing this, they will follow the crowd, you know, they'll go with the flow. Going with the flow now is always speeding as fast as you can. For many people, for many motorists, we've got to have a change of culture. Okay, thanks.
Thank you, Councillor Cook. Does anybody else have any questions? Councillor Cameron.
Sorry, just following on what Councillor Cook said. So have we already received the behavioural science? He was talking about motorist behaviour and typical behaviour and everything. So has the committee already received the behavioural science?
Councillor Cameron, I'll take that as a rhetorical question.
I'm deputising, so I didn't know if I'd missed something. And it sits with my committee as well.
We haven't received Thank you. That yet, but we have asked for it and we look forward to seeing it. Thank you. Are there any other questions? Councillor Collins.
Sorry, Chair. There was it's a comment more than anything else. I regularly use the A41 between Kemmel Laird and port sunlight and what have you, and what I must say is seeing the change in people's speeds along that road. I used to do it a long time, well, I've always done it, and I can see with the yellow, I don't know what those cameras are, but the fixed, the not variable speed, or what they call the, they're not just a speed camera, are they, that you've got to go through it for a certain period, so I can see them actually staying at 50 mile an hour, and I would like to see a few more of them across the world, because they actually do, I think they actually do the job of slowing cars down, because you've seen it, people go through speed cameras, they'll slow down, as soon as they go past it, they'll speed back up. These sort of cameras would be quite good. Are there any more plans to actually have them around the borough?
So, I should have said before, they are the variable speed limit cameras, and that is the sole example in Wirral, but you know that particular stretch of road did have a very high casualty rate, and therefore it qualified for having those types of cameras. But if others do meet that criteria, then of course, yeah, they can be looked at. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. Thanks, Simon. I think it's important to, I just want to make a few comments myself, actually. And I think it's important to note, with while we're really deeply scrutinising this document and all the information that we've been given, and we're obviously frustrated and would like things to move faster, deeply frustrated in some cases, but I think it's important to note the lag effect that Simon was talking about, in terms of we ask for something and then we want to see it delivered. So in the same meeting that we pass, this current year's spending plans, we also then give the recommendations for what we want to see in future road safety. And I think that's from that we have derived this kind of lag effect, where we're now reading a report which is retrospective, really. We're looking at how things were and where we're up to, and it's my hope that we will be moving in a different direction and doing things the way we recommended. I think it's also important to note that there's some really good stuff in this report. So I'd like to draw attention to some of the educational material that I've seen has actually been of a very high standard, and it would have been nice perhaps to have some visual examples of that educational material aimed at young people, aimed at the elderly. It might have been quite inspiring, some of that stuff. There's also, I'd like to also refer to, I had a comment also on the behavioural science, which is really interesting, and I really would like to see that, and I think that's a very good point that is made in the report. And also the idea that we are utilising external funding to recruit a dedicated school streets officer. This is very good. This is timely. This is important. So there are good things in this report, and we do tend to scrutinise and only pick out the negatives sometimes. So there are good things. I think the frustration is just that we have been wanting to move in this direction for a long, long time, but we only perhaps as a committee made that commitment to move towards borough-wide 20 miles per hour in March. And I'm really, really looking forward to seeing that progress and to getting that feedback and to getting the new update on how we're doing in those measures. With that in mind, if there's no more questions and no more comments about it, we move to the recommendations. And I have actually got an amendment on this. So the amendment, it's in addition to the recommendation that's given, I would like to add that the committee requests that officers focus on delivering each of the road safety working group's recommendations as an urgent priority, and asks that officers provide clear feedback on each recommendation before the end of this calendar year, detailing progress made in planning, funding, and implementation. I had another recommendation, which was that committee notes that 4.24 of this report omits full reference to the Department for Transport guidance on implementation of 20 miles per hour, which can be implemented on roads with average speeds above 24 miles per hour. Committee also notes that 4.25 of this report does not acknowledge that the data on collisions can never reflect the extent to which road safety fears drive behaviour choices in local travel. Roads may appear safe in terms of collision data because people are too scared to walk or cycle along them. Committee wishes these factors to inform the rollout of 20 mile per hour zones. So I've got printed copies of that. So I'll just hand those out if that's okay.
Well, While they're being handed out, is it possible to comment on the... Yeah. I was very impressed with the work at the Working Party and some recommendations we hadn't had in the past come through that, and I'm hoping the sentiment of the amendments is that they now work their way through into the future, and I think all parties would agree with that. I think your last sort of paragraph, if I'm reading it right or hearing it right, it's this issue I think Alan was talking about quality of life and perception. And I've always learned, being a long-toothed politician, perception is actually reality. If people perceive their road to be dangerous, then to them it is dangerous. And we have to accept that as part of the contribution to things we do. So it is about perception as well. But in the initial stages, and I'm pretty sure, having read through what Vision Zero means, it will mean that where there are actual accidents happening, then that's where the early resources will have to go, because you can't ignore those areas. But generally, as the programme moves out, picking up what Councillor Cook is saying, more and more of those areas, the norm is that it is 20 miles an hour, and the norm in your psyche is that it's 20 miles an hour. The other thing, I'm not sure, the technical, might be a technical question, but when I'm in a different place, different part of town or different country or different parts of Wales, for example, I always follow the advice on my sat-nav. Does everyone else do that? So you go through a village in Wales, I look at the advice on the sat-nav. Once we establish 20-mile-an-hour zones, will that information feed to individual people's sat-navs? Because when you're in unfamiliar territory, you don't want a ticket. And when you're in a home, it might be helpful as well that information comes up on your sat-nav. Most cars have sat-nav type technology, don't they? So I'm just wondering whether that is a fact or not.
Thanks, Steve. It's my understanding as the Highways Authority that it is our responsibility to let the sat-nav companies know, isn't it? Can you just confirm, please, Simon?
Yes, we do that, and we update the information on the data that sat-nav companies have. Yeah.
Thank you, Chair. Reflecting on what you just said recently, I think everybody wants the programme to move on at pace. I'm a little bit concerned that we need to do it properly, and I wouldn't want us to move on at pace and sort of falter, because we've just heard from the councillor about the situation in Manor Drive where the calming measures were put in place and it hasn't actually worked and it's had to be looked at again. There are a couple more that I could mention in the same sort of area that haven't worked properly. But also, and this came out in the workshop that we did on the reducing speed, and that was that signage alone doesn't work. So it will in some cases, but there are other areas where it takes additional measures, such as chicanes and so on and so forth. What we need to do is roll it out correctly. And if it needs the infrastructure to go with the signage, then it should be put in place. But I wouldn't like to do it too quickly where it's not effective. Thank you.
Thank you. I agree. I think that's a really important point. That's a very important point that we learn as we go on. As Simon said, we learn from the implementation, and it's going to be obviously closely audited. I really agree that we better to do it properly. Thank you. Can you make this very brief, please, Councillor Cook?
I will do, yeah. Am I allowed to talk a little bit about school streets? Because I had my hand up before and I wasn't noticed, but is that all right? Or?
As long as it's brief.
Yeah, it is brief. It's just I attended a demonstration of the Liscard school streets today, and I was impressed with what's going to happen, the communication to get people inside and the infrastructure, the fact it isn't very expensive, it's only about £10,000 and so on. But what I was a bit concerned about was how long ago this was decided on, how long ago the six schools were designated, and how little actually of substance appears to have happened yet. And the fact that, yes, we're going to appoint a dedicated school streets officer very shortly, this month apparently, but the other things, the consultation comms and the infrastructure, there's no date for that other than hopefully late in the year. You know, that to me, I'm just wondering why such, you know, a slow rate of progress there.
Thank you, Councillor Cook. As a teacher, I would just like to remind everybody that schools have been closed repeatedly, and it is very hard to implement school streets trials when the schools are closed. But that aside, I do feel it has been quite slow because we've been asking for this for quite some time. Simon, did you have anything to add to that?
No, you're absolutely right. Obviously, we do need to wait until the schools are back and able to consult properly on the measures that are introduced as part of school streets, but we are pressing on as quickly as we can with those schemes. Thank you.
That's great, thank you. So I think everybody's had time to look at the amended recommendations.
Yes, Chair, I'm happy to second that if you need a seconder.
Chair, sorry, can I just have 2 minutes with my group?
Yes.
a printer there. These are already prepared in advance. It would have been nice to actually have this earlier on, that we could have properly discussed this. We want to work together. We want to try and be open and transparent with each other, and getting this at the last minute, I don't think is fair. I don't think it's right. I noticed that your group were already aware of it because you didn't have your copies. Or I'm asking the question. There was nothing handed out as they went round, so I presume you'd already had. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. But I would ask that if we're going to have amendments to proposals, that we try and get them in beforehand, because this has been printed, so it would have been ready before we came in.
Actually, thank you. As you can see, there was nothing, no ulterior motives. We weren't deliberately keeping you in the dark. I did have a conversation with Councillor Mountlight earlier in the day where I ran through what we were hoping to propose, what we were thinking of, and then following a subsequent meeting of my group, we just came up basically with this at the very last minute, which you're allowed to do. You are allowed to amend things at committee, and that's what we're doing. But I did try and make sure that everybody is aware of the thought processes going into that beforehand. It's apologies if it was very last minute.
Yeah, but as I say, it's been printed out. So the thing is, it was printed out prior to the start of the meeting, so surely it could have been given us before the start of the meeting so we could look at it. That's what I'm asking for. I know they're done at short notice sometimes, but this must have been done before the start of the meeting.
Point taken, thank you. Does anybody else have anything to say about the actual amendment itself? It's been proposed, it's been seconded, so I suggest we vote on it now. Do we dare ask if that can be done by assent?
No.
No, it can't be done by assent.
Members, all those in favour of the motion that has been moved by Councillor Gray and seconded by Councillor Brame? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And those against? 4. Any abstentions? No. I think that motion is carried, Chair.
Thank you. Thank you, Vicky, and I'd like to thank all the officers as well involved in producing that. This brings us on to item 7, which is the weed control options appraisal.
With not being rude, Chair, do we not have to move the substantive amended motion?
Sorry. Yeah, sorry.
Councillor Fowkes, the recommendation in the report is only an officer recommendation, but Councillor Gray has moved a motion. And that was seconded by Councillor Brame. It wasn't an amendment because nobody had already moved what was in the report.
So can I just clarify that it contains the... It's in addition to the... It is in addition to the recommendations that are already there. Yeah.
Yes. What has been moved and voted upon is what's in the recommendation plus what Councillor Gray added, and that was the substantive motion that was moved. No, because the as I say, the recommendation in the report is only an officer recommendation. Members are free to move something completely different to that if they wish to, and Councillor Gray has moved something which did include those words that are in the report, but also included additional wording, and that has been voted on by the committee.
To be fair to Councillor Flux, thank you for clarifying, because I've never been in a situation to date where an amendment of a councillor's motion or an officer's recommendation hasn't been amended last minute. So I'm getting pretty used to it now.
Thank you, Councillor Cameron. I think that really does bring us on to item 7, which is the weed control options appraisal. And this can be found on pages 281 to page 328 of the agenda pack. And I'd like to invite Mike Coburn to present this report, please. Mike.
Thanks, Chair. So this report and the service obviously reflects the weed control service that you're obviously all aware of, and you see it happening in your wards, etc. Just to clarify, The reason for needing this recommendation is that the previous contract ran out during the summer of the pandemic, and there was a need to introduce an interim one-year contract which started at the start of this calendar year and runs out at the end of the calendar year. So the current contract runs out on the 31st of December, so 16 weeks' time. The interim contract was put in place to allow us to carry out an options appraisal. We did that as officers, looking at a number of ways of alternative delivery mechanisms. One was that we considered an in-house provision through the Parks Countryside grounds maintenance function, that we did some work, collaborative work with neighbouring authorities, that we varied the contract with BIFA. The BIFA contract has a responsibility for weed removal, not treatment, but removal, so they're responsible for that as part of their street cleansing operation, or to go to competitive tender. We looked at a number of those options. You've got the report and the appendices within them. Part of that includes a detailed overview of the in-house provision option and costs, which are set out in one of the appendices. We felt that if BIFA were interested in this contract, then they should be they can tender for the contract in the normal way with a competition. And neighbourhood authorities, actually, people like Cheshire West, were lukewarm. They had other priorities at the time. So our recommendation to you, as set out in the report, is to go out to tender and to put the contract out to competitive tender as soon as possible. I mentioned the contract length. We need, as the report says, to press on with the tendering process once you've approved it. Because there is no facility to extend this contract. It ends at the end of December, and we won't have a facility in place next year. We won't be able to mobilise that if we don't manage the tender this year and award the contract for the start. If you recall, there were difficulties with the previous contract starting late. I think the mobilisation was in the end around mid-summer, because the late start to it and problems getting the contract started, that resulted in significant weed growth problems. I think your previous incarnate, the overview scrutiny committee, had a special meeting on that position. So the need to have a facility and arrangement in place for the start of the next season is imperative, and that's why we make the recommendations to you this evening. Thanks, Chair.
Thank you, Mike. Before I say anything, I'll just ask if anybody has any comments or questions. Steve.
Just a technical question around where the weed spraying takes place. Does the current contract cover unadopted alleyways?
No, it doesn't. But the recommendation is that the specification is amended to include unadopted alleyways moving forward.
You see, one of the things I think it's general consensus that weed spraying is a difficult subject for us to deal with. On one hand, we have a lobby who don't want us to use the most efficient method for very valid environmental reasons. We take that on board. And then we have, you know, fairly sharp divide, those who weeds are abhorrent, and what am I paying my council tax for? Get rid of them. Use whatever you can. You know, the nuclear option wouldn't even worry them. And we have to negotiate our way through as a committee and as a council and at the image of the borough through that mini minefield. The other thing that we're anxious to explore, and I think other members of all parties should be given some time to explore, is an almost vision of a universal service within this realm of work. So grass cutting, parks, grass on the side of the highways, there seems to be a myriad of groups doing it. And now, obviously, the weed spraying seems to be is in the hand of a contract, which the specification of the contract, they will work most companies were worked at our specification. So my view is that it's not perfect service at the moment. It does draw an awful lot of criticism. So we should have been doing more work, and obviously COVID got in the way of all sorts of things, doing more work of exploring that business case and that option for having full hands-on control to a highly visible public service. And I have great faith in public service, if managed correctly and if it's done correctly, that we could end up with something better. And to throw away the opportunity of, or throw away an opportunity of locking ourselves into what would be, is it a four-year contract, will almost be, and we've had lots of debates about getting in and out of contracts, haven't we? We lock ourselves into a situation where, for the want of a bit more time, we may come up with a better solution for our citizens. So I'm going to pose the question to people, is it possible to tender this contract for a reasonably short period of time as is possible to enable either a working group or the officers to go away and really sweat out the numbers in terms of a universal in-house service? And I don't think those numbers have been sweat or enough. And I'm not preempting. Because they may do all the hard work. They may come back and say, it's just not practical. And then we're in a situation where we retender the contract. They just don't want us to lock us into 4 years for the want of having time. And I understand we need to have something ready to go. What we can't afford to do, and I take on what the officers just said, can't afford to be in a situation where there's nothing ready to be up and running. So as we've seen, one of the drawbacks would be we would have to raise capital to buy the equipment if we were to do it and all that other stuff. So it doesn't give us time. So I'm asking legally and technically, would it be possible to change the wording to a one-year contract, and that would give all sides time to get round the table and see where we want to go in the future?
Mike, is that okay to answer, please?
Chair, that is possible. Obviously, that's a decision that you will make as a committee. Obviously, a shorter contract may result in not the best value in terms of risk rate coming back because of the risk that the private sector will consider. However, I would be confident that we would receive tenders for that contract. It is possible to, for instance, award a contract with an extension option. Which we could either use or not use, depending on what decision we make about that piece of work you've just referred to. We do need to be out. We must have something in place for next year because of the issues you raised. But it would give us time to consider the options that you've raised. It was remiss of me at the start, Chair, to not introduce Steve Henderson and Neil Garnett from the Parks Countryside team. They're the key supervisors over that service and others. And they would be heavily involved in the piece of work that you just referred to. So they can answer questions if there are questions about the in-house option. It's certainly clear, colleagues, that we wouldn't be able to mobilise an in-house provision option ready in time for next season. That is clear. We'd need time to mobilise if that was a decision that came.
Thanks, Mike. Any other questions? No, Councillor Martin, go on.
Chair, thank you.
Sorry, I owe apologies to Councillor Brame. I did say I'd go to Councillor Brame next. I'm really sorry about that. Councillor Brame.
Thank you, Chair. We've got another example of the lag effect, actually, here, because picking up what Steve was saying about the weeds in unadopted alleys, I know it's an issue that affects parts of his ward as it affects parts of mine, and I'm delighted to see that it is in going to be part of the new contract, because in October 2019, I actually moved a resolution in council asking for that service to be spread to unadopted alleyways, and it was actually passed unanimously. So there's been a bit of a lag between saying that's what we wanted to do and actually seeing it take place in this new contract. So that is excellent, because it is a real nightmare for a lot of our unadopted alleys, which become real terrible eyesores with weeds growing everywhere, and affects lots of parts of Birkenhead, and possibly other parts of the borough too, but I know about Birkenhead. But I'd just like a little bit of clarification about the different costings between going out to an outside tenderer and bringing it in-house. Now, I understand that we've got all the cost of buying equipment and all the, those capital costs, but if they are stripped out, is the cost of doing it ourselves or getting an outside contractor to do it, are they roughly comparable? And do those capital costs sort of come from a different budget? I'm not an expert on finance, but revenue and capital do seem to be quite sort of different budgets. Could we just have a bit of a clarification about that and why it's going to be so much more expensive if we take it on ourselves? And if we delayed for a year, perhaps, as Steve was suggesting, would that make any particular difference to those financial issues?
The unadopted issue, that I'll take that on board. In terms of the costings for the capital, sorry, for the in-house provision vis-a-vis the existing contracts, the capital outlay costs, I mean, they're obviously, it's a standing start for anyone other than the incumbent contractor to need to get the equipment in, so that's an issue. But that made no material difference to the comparison in cost. So basically, because of the position with the Parks and Countryside grounds maintenance operative function, there isn't the internal capacity within that team. We would need to generate the new resource. So effectively, it's non-operatives that we would need to be able to deliver the service. And there's a challenge, because this would be the term of reference for the working group, but there is a challenge about how we deploy that workforce. The private sector can be more flexible than us. That was our view. That was the costings comparison. Capital made no material difference to the comparison. It was the revenue costs. I mean, I don't want to put Steve on the spot, but Steve Henderson, did the calculations, and it's correct, Steve, in that it's effectively a new workforce that we need to recruit.
Hi, Mike. Yeah. Yes, we'd have to recruit from scratch, and there's not many operatives out there with the required certification. So we'd have to put lots of people through new training, and that's not just for pesticide application; it's for quad bike. I tried a couple of years ago to get a couple of operatives, and there was no one out there at all, and we'd have to train them right from the beginning. So that's, to get a workforce now, we'd have to have about 8 people trained up, and possibly a few more in case of sickness, annual leave, and the likes of.
Well, that's very helpful, thank you. So in that case, delaying it for a year isn't going to affect the figures at all, is it? We're just simply delaying the issue for another year.
I'll start that response. That answer is that, the issue about a universal service is something we can consider. I think that's the option that's been proposed, and we're happy to consider that. If that's what we're asked to do, what we're instructed to do, we can look at that. There are potentially, we need to look at this, but there are potentially economies of scale, etc. You may say, that should be reflected in the current business case, but we can look at it. We'll go back and look at it again about how that can work in-house.
Steve.
Yeah, I think we're not asking the impossible. Where we have a desire to fully explore another option. And quite perversely, I'm thinking, if it was let on a year with the opportunities to extend, you'd really want to impress in that year, wouldn't you? As the contractor, you'd want to really make a go of it for the long term. So it could be you know, a win-win situation or a no-lose situation in my own naive mind. In my own naive mind, I think we should be moving towards a workforce in and around this area who are multi-skilled. If you go into industry where I work, people are multi-skilled. So one day when it's not possible to cut grass, you could go out weed spraying. One day when you're not doing something else, you know, that's to me is the modern workforce. We pay, you know, we pay reasonable wages, the living wage, which is what we're committed to. My view is that we would be able to recruit from other contracting companies to go and work with pride for the local authority. So my view is that many authorities have brought this type of service back in to public, to council in-house because of the control and because of the high profile of it. I'm not saying it will happen. I'm saying we need to give ourselves room to attempt to make it happen. And I think by a 1 year with potential to extend gets us out of the hole of not having a service next year ready to go, but gives us time to investigate. And I think that's the sentiment of the amendment and the will. If people don't disagree, that's okay. It's a democracy, isn't it?
Thanks, Steve. I was just about to announce that in the light of the conversations that we had before the start of this meeting, where we were discussing the fact that we felt that we really hadn't been given perhaps enough time to focus on this. Vicky has very kindly, using her legal mind, taken our thoughts together, and there is a proposed amendment here, which I'm going to actually ask Vicky to read out since it's her handwriting.
Chair, just before you do that, can I ask a couple of questions?
Yes.
Mike, you said earlier on that you've amended the service provision to take in unadopted alleyways, or you will. The service provision that was provided this year, presumably also have had lots of complaints. Was the contract fully performed as per the request, the provision?
Again, I'll ask Steve to answer that. There was obviously we all experience different weather this summer and spring, and that affects weed spraying. So I'll ask Steve to respond to that. But yeah, as has been said already tonight, it's an issue that is high profile. People feel strongly about. I think the early performance this year was positive. We were ahead because of dry weather, etc. There are issues, as Steve will explain. You know, I'm sitting here now and we're getting complaints about adopted alleyways and we're having to respond because of issues that seem to have developed in certain parts of the borough. We're taking that on the chin and we're investigating those. So performance there's accusations that they've been overzealous, they've not turned the machines off in transit, etc. So those things are being investigated. It's something that we're looking at. But in terms of the position where we started the contract 2 years ago, there's a more consistent position there. Obviously, it was affected by the pandemic when we suspended services last summer. But yeah, it's an ongoing issue. I'll ask Steve to clarify the position this season. Steve.
Hi, thanks, Mike. Yeah, we started off in March with the spraying, and Mancoed, well, the incumbent, got around very quick. Within about 8 weeks, the whole of the borough. And we noticed then that after about 3 weeks of them starting, the first area started to start getting green again. And that's due to, if we go and spray, there wasn't any visible weeds out there a lot. So as they were going around spraying, they were getting the green stuff. But the day after, if stuff starts to germinate, it could take us 10-12 weeks to get back around. And that's where the problem is getting the timing right at the beginning, because I do think that we probably started a little bit earlier than what we could have, but then we were playing with the weather as well. You know, the second spray, we've lost about five working weeks of spraying, which is, you know, it's like half the borough, really, that we were behind on, and that's contributed with detritus acting as seed beds that's caused the weed to grow with wet weather, and now this, you know, and it's this just finished their second spray now and just starting on their third. And that's all at the moment.
Thanks, Steve.
Sorry, just a couple. The cost of a 12-month contract compared to your estimate of 250,000 a year, what are we talking for a single year as opposed to a 3 year?
If it's a new contractor, they would obviously, I would add at least 25% onto that for them to set up. I'm thinking to make it viable for them to do for 1 year. That's my estimate.
Obviously, the incumbent may decide to tender, and obviously they're in place with that setup, so that wouldn't be incurred if it was the incumbent that won the contract in open competition.
I mean, if I tender for a single year contract, I put the price up. They will do that, presumably.
Obviously, they'll consider the risk of a 1 year. But what was proposed is a 1 year with a several year extension option, so we can decide, and they can make the decision on their tender based on what it would be a 1 year plus several years or 2 year extension.
Last one, Chair. Thank you. We've been talking about contracts, and in our discussions, there were discussions about the percentage chance of winning. What are the percentage chances of a different option to glyphosate coming out in the next 2 or 3 years? I see there's lots and lots of correspondence with other councils, and everybody's saying, no idea, mate.
My response, and Steve and Neil have done the tests and trials, etc., is that the UK or Europe is looking for the alternative. We're all in the same sort of approach. Our approach, as you know, is to reduce glyphosate use, and we've done that, as the report says, by 50%, particularly our urban parks, etc., is no longer used there, or unless there's exceptional circumstances. But people are pursuing that alternative. But the alternative, you've received two reports today as a committee about the alternatives, and they are either not affordable or not working, not the desired effect. We're talking about problems with the current regime. So in terms of percentage, we continue to pursue it. The hope is that with everyone looking for the alternatives and public concern and the license due to end in 2025, that the alternative will be there, and we will build that into the contract that we can use the alternative method and treatment.
I've been sent an email from a resident saying that the
Sorry, Councillor Martin, you did say that was going to be the last thing that you said, so I would appreciate being able to ask Councillor Collins. He's been waiting very patiently. Thank you, Councillor Collins.
Thanks, Chair. Not that I like to agree too much with Steve occasionally, but I'll agree with Steve on this one. If we are looking at having in-house, this is a very seasonal project, shall we say, of weed killing. It is not a 365-day-a-year process. It is a seasonal. So when we are looking at potentially having in-house staff, they would have to be multi-skilled unless we're only going to go for seasonal staff. And as someone who was on that side of the fence, multi-skilled, using the weed killer, using the machines and everything else, I just can't understand why we would have to look for a brand new workforce when we should have staff already qualified, trained, and able to do the job. Yes, we may have to add to it, but I don't see why we can't utilise the staff some of the staff we've already got.
Councillor Collins, can I just check if you wanted anybody to answer that, or that was a statement? Okay.
Our workforce currently are multi-task because we've got so many full-timers, and mainly our grass-cutting teams are seasonal. So they will go, they end in October, and the full-time staff that were left then go on to do all the shrub pruning and all the hedge cutting during the winter period. So to add to more, we haven't got that work for them, for the new workforce to carry on or to add to. We haven't got that work on the highway bridge areas.
Thank you, Steve. Any other questions? Councillor Cook.
First, good to say I'm gratified to hear that there has been a substantial reduction in the use of glyphosate since, as it says in the report here, 0.3.3, page 284. The council did make a commitment back on 15th July 2019, over 2 years ago, to phase out the use of glyphosate and reduce the amount used. So you've reduced that. That's reassuring to hear the extent to which that's happened. I'd just like to add my reflections on the potential for moving this service in-house, perhaps combining it with other services like grass cutting and having a pool of multi-skilled workers employed directly by the council. I think that's a great idea. And the other thing that occurs to me is that we have discussed, and there is limited reference to it in the report, engaging community volunteer groups for doing quite a lot of weeding. Now, I was a little disappointed by the report, which does seem to be rather putting down the potential for that. But one thing I would say is it would be much easier to integrate it with an in-house service than with contractors, external contractors. I can imagine it would be very difficult to coordinate that, and you'd have to be predicting to some extent in advance how much work you wanted them to do and stuff. And if you've got loads of community groups coming to the fore, they'd be saying, well, we're contracted to do so much, therefore, you're going to have to pay anyway. But with a more flexible in-house council service, I would have thought it'd be easier to do that. But can I just come to the wording of the reference to volunteer groups, which I felt was rather condescending towards existing volunteers, community groups, because it does talk about, this is page 283, paragraph 2.8, about manual hand scraping used by community groups generated a significant potential health and safety risk. But, I mean, these are people who've come together on a voluntary basis, presumably with some experience of doing this, and then to be sort of told, well, we're worried about you doing yourself an injury. I think volunteers, who've actually wanted to do this and probably got some experience of doing it in their own backyard, to say that the council's concerned with health and safety, I think that's a bit condescending towards volunteers. And I think we need to be doing everything we can to encourage community groups to get involved, because I think that's partially the way forward too, and that could be better integrated with an in-house service. Yeah.
Thank you, Councillor Cook. Any further comments or questions? I've been Councillor Collinson.
Just to say that on the Nocturum estate, the good people there are actually doing it now, because they're fed up of prams tipping over and wheelchairs being affected by the amount of weeds. So they have sort of took ownership of it. And, I think maybe that is something we should take into consideration as well, because they're quite happy to do it as a community, even though there will be calls that, they do pay the council tax, but collectively as a community they're really happy to work together to make sure the area looks a little bit better. Thank you.
That's a really good point, Councillor Collinson. Thank you for raising that. And it does remind me of our previous conversations about the Wirral Wombles and various other fantastic groups like the New Brighteners who do sometimes actually put themselves in situations where we might consider that it's a health and safety risk in order to do very important voluntary work, which we do support, and also which is, it's actually really good for people. We know it's proven to be really good for people to take part in voluntary work. So I echo that. I really would like to see more information about how we can work with volunteer groups. I think going back to the...
Sorry, Chair, can I just make one very brief comment, just so the committee are no illusions. Of course, we talked about volunteers at the previous meeting and support and how they enhance our services. The health and safety issue is purely about working on the on the highway, not about weeding and working on those. It was working on the carriageway was the issue that was recalled in the report.
So can I just clarify, when people are weeding on a pavement, we're okay with that, as we would be with the Wirral Wombles picking up on a pavement?
Yeah. It's the carriageway that we were obviously concerned about, and anything that's adjacent to the carriageway.
That's really useful. That's really useful for us to know that. Thank you.
It makes a separate point. Sorry, I have to challenge that, because it does make a separate point about concerns for safety, people doing it on the highway. The other point is about, you know, people getting complaining of back pain after doing it, you know, perhaps stooping down. You know, now people who are regular volunteers in community groups would only be getting this if they're doing it for the first time. Like all of us know, if we do something the first time, like me cycling uphill, you know, and haven't done it for a few weeks, I get back pain because my muscles, you know, aren't sort of trimmed for it. Anyway.
Chair, I'm sorry, aren't we talking about two different things? We're talking about a volunteer group who might do the outside their house or houses, and somebody being contracted or asked to deliver a service. They're two completely different issues.
It's not, because obviously it's they complement each other. So that's the idea that we would like to explore, the idea of these volunteer groups potentially complementing.
But we've got 247,000 miles or something.
Sorry, Councillor Mountney, I'm going to ask if I can carry on with what I was trying to say before, and that was that I was it was quite inspiring to hear what I think is the experience and vision that Steve Fowkes was using to describe what we could have with the multidisciplinary team and the multi-skilled team, rather. And I'm also mindful of how we've been talking, the need to balance the potentially conflicting expectations of our residents, and we obviously all need to be really mindful of that. And mindful that we've declared a climate and biodiversity emergency. We declared an environment and climate emergency. So that has to be borne in mind. And as Councillor Cook pointed out, we did say we would be working to phase out glyphosate. We need to be mindful of our dire budgetary crisis as well. So our expectations in terms of the environment and our expectations in terms of what we can actually afford, we have to look closely at whether we can match those. Therefore, I think we need to take some time to do this properly. And I do think, bearing in mind what was said last night at full council, the working group that would be there to answer some of Councillor Gilchrist's questions, I think it's important that perhaps that working group could look into this. And in the meantime, with the clock ticking on the need to get this contract sorted, I think a reduced term of contract should be considered. So with that, with all of those issues in mind that we've raised tonight, I'd like to ask Vicky to perhaps read that suggested amendment so that we can all think about it. Thank you.
Thank you, members. The wording that I've written down is that the committee does not support the option presented in the report to procure a weed control contract for a term of up to 4 years and wishes to have more information before deciding on a long-term option for weed control. Committee would like further information on a fully integrated in-house service covering all aspects of edge of highways and street maintenance, including but not necessarily limited to grass cutting and weed control. Committee therefore requests that the Director of Neighbourhoods reports back to the committee as soon as possible with the above information. In the meantime, the committee agrees to the commencement of a tender process for the procurement of a weed control service for a contract for a period of 1 year. I don't know whether members then wish to include the option to extend and how long you would wish to that option to be for. And then the committee also agrees to give delegated authority to the Director of Neighbourhood Services to award the one-year contract within approved budget and to the highest scoring tenderer within approved budget and in accordance with the most economically advantageous tender, often known as the MEET criteria. So that's taking some of the wording from the current recommendation, plus some of the comments that have been made by members this evening. So I don't know, as I say, how long members wish to extend.
Yeah,
for.
Just to ask some professional advice, what would you suggest for a reasonable extension of the contract? Keep it at four years?
2 years.
2 years, okay.
Okay, so that would read that we'd commence a tender process for the procurement of a weed control service contract for a period of 1 year with an option to extend for 2 years.
Can I just say that I would be happy to consider that personally, I don't know about everybody else, if the extension was run by the committee first. Otherwise, we're basically agreeing to if there is a need to extend, that comes back to committee, perhaps, rather than it's just an automatic extension. Otherwise, we're looking potentially at a 3-year contract, aren't we? And we wanted a 1-year contract. Does that make sense? Councillor Cameron.
Hi, I'm sorry. Officers have been told there's a lag between decisions being made and then being enacted, and contract negotiation is difficult as it is. Delegated authority was the only interesting bit I heard in that, because I think it's about time to let officers get on with what needs to be done in the time scale that it needs to be done, having already agreed the budget. So, you know, we're concerned about contract variations, we're concerned about to-in and fro-in, committee's lengthening now the process on something that has to take place, and now you want to come back to committee, details on the extension. Let's just box this off tonight and let them get on with their job.
Thank you, Councillor Cameron. It's my belief that this is policy-making committee, and so it's perfectly sensible that we should be making policy. Does anybody else have any comments to make? Councillor Bray, sorry, Councillor Fowkes was already speaking.
Go on. I think you were first.
Thanks, Steve. I'm going to ask the question is, how long would it take us to actually set up, if we go for an in-house service, how long it would actually take us to set that up and go? Because I'm a bit concerned that we go from a one-year to a potential three-year contract. Why can't we go from 1 year to a possible extension of a one-year rather than a two-year? If we decide as a committee we're going to go with the in-house service, how long would that take to actually settle?
Chair, I think the idea is that we make the decision in that year, and then about the in-house provision, and then take it from there about the extension, whether that's needed or not.
Thank you. Thank you, Councillor.
Just clarify, so what you're saying is we award the contract for next year, but we will have it up, if we decide to actually go as an in-house tender, in-house contract, that we will have them on the 1st of January 2023, we'd have them ready to go then, so we wouldn't have to do an extension.
Presumably that's the purpose of a one-year contract.
So are you suggesting, Councillor Collins, a one-year contract with a one-year extension? Which would be my preference.
I think that would be a good way to go.
I'm happy to second that if that's been proposed.
So, Councillor Cameron, you're seconding my proposal? Or?
No, I didn't hear a specific about the extension in that proposal. I was very concerned that you wanted the extension period to come back to committee as part of the contract negotiations. I want to hear clarity around exactly what officers can go away today and start doing versus what the committee will then take a longer term decision on policy-wise. There's a short term initiative has to take place. There's a longer term policy that we'll get to in probably subsequent committees. Tonight, are officers able to have a clear indication of the type of contract they're going in towards to negotiate?
So based on what Councillor Collins has just said, I was proposing that we go with his suggestion of a one-year contract with a one-year extension. If anybody wants to second that, then I'm sure that if you're in agreement with the rest of the proposal, then we could move
no,
to a vote.
No, I've made it clear I'm not in agreement with the rest of the proposal that talks about, can you please reread the bit that's about coming back to committee? That's the bit I heard, which I just keep hearing. It comes back to committee
again.
Sorry,
Councillor Cameron, I think you're misunderstanding me. I wanted that the committee was informed, because there have been times when contracts are extended and councillors are not informed. And I think as the policy-making committee, we would want to be informed that that was on the cards, that was likely to happen. Perhaps if we hadn't, as a working group, made an alternative suggestion during that year.
Second reading would just be handy.
Councillor Berry, sorry.
I was first.
Councillor Fox,
yeah. Councillor Berry. I'm struggling, Helen, to understand what you're actually saying. You're saying just accept this report in its totality and officers run the committee. Well, actually, no.
No.
Councillors,
sorry, you misquoted me.
Okay, well, if I'm not putting words in your mouth, I'll apologise. But we have all faced the criticism about what is a service that is high profile. I think it's time we, as councillors, and on the committee system, we can make policy, is to actually try and take control of that and react to the public's reaction and be responsible for it as a collective committee. Officers have come with recommendations to effectively go into the to keep this contract for a four-year period in the private sector. I think there's a belief that we can do it in-house and have control and be more reactive to our citizens if we are in control. And okay, if that's what we're saying. If it's just a technical thing about the length of the contract, I did ask advice what the extension should be. If we want to change that, that's not a problem for me. But the other thing is that we should not be preemptive within this decision here. We have not seen the option of in-house yet. We've not seen what the tender is going to be like for future. So, and you know, people who are bidding for the contract should not believe we have a closed mind to the extension of the contract or a private contract. We need to have an open mind. So we just to be careful of the language that we use, that we are discussing options with no, you know, we haven't made our mind up yet. We have a desire. The will of the councillors is the officers to try and carry out that desire. If it's not possible, they will tell us, or if we don't believe it's possible, we can change our mind as we go along. That's the nature of what we do.
Thanks. I thought that's the point at which we were at. Thanks.
Councillor Berry.
Yeah, just a little bit of clarification, if possible. I think Councillor Collins has just said about a 12-month in-house contract. If that was the case, is that right? Is that
no. It was 12-month external contract with a potential 12-month extension while we set it up. But if we're going to have,
if we're going to have an internal contract set up within a year, then I'm saying the extension may be a year, but that's what I'm saying is it's an external contract, it's not an internal contract. We haven't got the staff to do it.
Is that clear? Thank you. Thanks. So, Vicky, could you read that again for us all?
The wording would be, committee does not support the option presented in the report to procure a weed control contract for a term of up to 4 years and wishes to have more information before deciding on a long-term option for weed control. Committee would like further information on a fully integrated in-house service covering all aspects of edge of highways and street maintenance, including but not necessarily limited to grass cutting and weed control. Committee therefore requests that the Director of Neighbourhoods reports back to the committee as soon as possible with the above information. In the meantime, the committee agrees to the commencement of a tender process for the procurement of a weed control service contract for a period of 1 year with an option to extend for 1 year. The committee also agrees to give delegated authority to the Director of Neighbourhood Services to award the 1 year contract with an option to extend for 1 year within approved budget and to the highest scoring tender within approved budget and in accordance with the most economically advantageous tender criteria.
Thank you, Vicky. Thank you. Councillor Collins, just...
I'm more than happy to propose that.
Okay, thank you. So if that's proposed, I'm quite happy to second that because I think we need to move to the vote now.
Do we need a vote or can we agree it by assent?
Chair, can we just clarify, I mean, I think it's right, that this 1 year contract still includes the treatment of weeds in unadopted alleyways. That's still part of the deal.
Again, just one little detail towards the end. It all read fine. Just towards the end, when it says the option to extend for a further year, should it be made explicit that that's a political decision of this committee, that it's not, you know, just the officers' delegated power? Because I think that was an important point, wasn't it, as well? That yeah? Is that agreed?
I think we did agree that.
Yeah. Just should it be explicit, though, in the wording, that's all? With the option to be extended by a committee or... Committee decision.
My understanding, Councillor Cook, was that the committee was content that on the basis that the director was going to be bringing back a report relatively soon in terms of the other options, that members would then be able to express their view about whether or not a further extension was necessary at that point, and I'm sure the director, having heard the discussion tonight, would be happy to confirm to the committee that before extending the contract, yeah. she would bring it back to members. And clearly, there is a very defined two-year limitation yeah. now on any contract that is procured. Mm.
I'd understood that from all the discussion. It's just the wording at the end, whether it should be explicit or not. Just at the very end, but that's up to you. You know, you're the legal expert.
Yeah, thank you. I'm happy to confirm we will do that dual piece of work, report back to committee. We obviously have, budget pressures, which would need to be considered as well as part of this piece of work and is documented in the report. But yes, happy to confirm we'll do that. And then it does give us that business continuity in terms of a service offer from January next year to have a weed spraying contract in place.
Thanks, Nikki. That's very helpful. Thank you, Vicky.
I think that was agreed by assent members. Thank you.
So I'd like to thank the officers for that because that was obviously quite a demanding piece of work.
Chair, can I suggest, mindful of time, I know we don't have a guillotine on committee meetings, but this is...
Yeah, we do need to move on.
For health and well-being, if we can rapidly close the meeting.
Yeah. So with that in mind, this brings us to item 8, which is quarter one budget monitoring, which is on pages 329 to 342 of the agenda pack. And I'd like to invite Sarah Cox to present the report, please. Thank you.
This report, this finance report for Environment, Climate, Emergency and Transport Committee shows financial monitoring information for quarter one, 21-22. The recommendations for this report are as follows. Note the year-end forecast revenue position as at quarter one of 850,000 adverse variance. Note the progress on achievement of approved savings. Note the reserves allocated to this committee. And note the year-end forecast capital position of just over 1.143 million adverse variance. Just briefly go through revenue monitoring. The revenue forecast position is projected to be 850,000 adverse as at quarter one. This is mainly due to highways and infrastructure and the other areas for parks and environments and climate emergency are currently projected to be balanced. The adverse variance is mainly due to car parking for 700,000 as the saving was not implemented until later in the year and there was just delays with implementing part of the saving and some will be delayed while consultation takes place. Footfall for the car parking is 75% of pre-COVID levels as at quarter one and this government sales fees and charges income loss compensation scheme is available up to the end of quarter one. Savings progress briefly. Most savings for this committee are on track to be fully achieved. The only exception relates to the car parking saving, which is currently reported as 300k achieved to date out of the 1 million forecast, which is projected. It's expected as of next year, we're projecting to achieve the saving in full. Moving on to reserves. At the moment, reserves will be reviewed each quarter to look at what spend will be happening in future quarters. But as at the moment, we're projecting to use 374,000 of reserves as at quarter one. And we'll come back and look at that in future quarters to see if there's any more drawdown on reserves. Then just moving on to capital. In Table 5, it shows a briefly summarised version of capital schemes. And because there's so many capital schemes for this committee, it's broken down into more detail in Appendix A with details of each of the schemes and what they're made up of. An adverse variance on this is currently reported of 1.143 million. This is due to additional amounts being input into the capital scheme for mainly LED lighting and roads and bridges. And in addition to this, several schemes relating to flooding have been slipped into next financial year. So that concludes a brief summary of the capital area and of the finance report. And I'm either happy to take any questions or take any questions back for my colleagues to answer if they can't be answered tonight. Thank you.
Thanks, Sarah. Do we have any questions? Councillor Cameron.
Thanks, Sarah. Thank you for staying for so long, and I'm sorry to repeat a question from a previous committee that you've already heard, but there's a few elements that need to come into this CAPEX appendix from the other half of the directorate, which relate to parks, machinery and vehicles. So I know you took that away and you're going to go through that list.
Yeah, we're looking at currently reviewing that as an action for being like corrective for quarter two. So we're looking into that at the moment, and then we can review it and see if you're, obviously you as a committee, as a tourism committee, are happy with what we've included for what we report on quarter
Thank
two.
You.
Thank you for that. Does anybody else have any comments or questions? Councillor Bray.
Just a very quick one, Chair. I wonder if we have an explanation why we've got this extra spending on the street lighting. I thought this was a programme that's already been agreed. How come we've incurred additional costs?
It was just additionally, it has been agreed, it's just additionally been added to the programme, because when we compare the adverse variance, we look at what was originally agreed, and that was what was originally agreed, and then we've added extra in, so it's already been added in. But it's just reported as an adverse variance because we're reporting it compared to what the base budget like was agreed, which was agreed.
Thank you. If there's no further comments or questions for Sarah, then I would move to the recommendation. The recommendation is that the Environment, Climate, Emergency and Transport Committee is requested to note the projected year-end revenue forecast position as reported at quarter one, to note progress on the achievement of approved savings and the projected year-end forecast position at quarter one, note the reserves allocated to the committee for future one-off commitments, and to note projected year-end capital forecast position as reported at quarter one. Can we agree that by assent, if I propose that, rather? I need to propose in a second. So if I propose that, could I have seconded? And then can we agree that by assent? Great, thank you very much, thank you. So this brings us to item 9, which is the appointment to Hilbury Island Nature Reserve Management Committee, which can be found on pages 343 to 348 of the report. And I'd like to invite Vicky Shaw to present this report. Thank you, Vicky.
Thank you, Chair. As members, the purpose of this report is to enable the committee to review the continuing need for the Hilbury Island Nature Reserve Management Committee and to appoint members to the committee for this municipal year. The management committee stems from the management plan for the Hilbury Island Nature Reserve and contains the Friends Group and other partners who are involved with the islands, such as the Hilbury Bird Observatory, leaseholders, an archaeological group, and elected members and council officers. Members will see in the report that the numbers of members appointed to this committee is 8 in accordance with the Constitution. The members who were appointed previously are listed in the report. It was Councillor Muspratt, Councillor Williams, Councillor Cox, Councillor Green, Councillor Hobson, Councillor Wright, Councillor Brame and Councillor Corkhill. And as I say, members are being invited this evening to appoint new members to that committee if you feel that the committee should continue to meet. I think officers would recommend that it does carry out a very beneficial function in enabling officers and members to engage with stakeholders and discuss issues in relation to the island.
Thank you, Vicky. Does anybody have any questions about that?
Chair, I would, please. Sorry, do you know how long the committee's been in existence?
I can't tell you the exact date, but I've worked for the council for many years and I seem to recall it being there for a very long time.
And always previously made up of councillors from that area, predominantly, and never been on a proportional basis before?
I think some councillors certainly who within whose ward it falls have been on it. I think in the past it's very much been members who are interested in the island and in the work that the committee does, as opposed to anything else.
And clearly, as it's going to change the constitution, it's never been politically based before.
Thank you, Councillor Martin. Councillor Fowkes.
Can I suggest, Chair, that it does not go to being politically based? It's not, from my view, it's not that sort of committee, and the people whose the island will be most precious to will be the three ward councillors, quite clearly. So my view would be that it's not really a decision we could make. If party leaders could get interest from maybe each party represented, but not on a political basis. And if the three ward councillors will have a deep interest in it, I'm always worried about these things, people getting put on in their absence and not turning up. I'd rather have a full complement turning up than you know, a political basis. So I'd refer this for discussion for the leaders group to come to a sensible arrangement.
Before going to, thank you, Councillor Fox. Before going to Councillor Cook, can I just point out that I think if it were politically proportionate, then ward councillors could make up the Conservative Party's allocation. You know, at least two of them could make it. Local ward councillors could have at least two voices there. I'll move to Councillor Cook now. Sorry, apologies.
I do know one or two of the volunteers who work in Hilbert Island and consulted them on this, and did they feel it'd be useful to have councillor involvement on this? And what I heard was that a lot of the meetings recently with councillors had been cancelled as though the council group had almost fallen into abeyance. So it suggests that perhaps, and I'm quite happy for someone to contradict this, perhaps somebody's on the committee at the moment, but you know, perhaps it'd be better to have an influx of new blood, and so people who are generally, you know, keen. And I know certainly there are members in my group who would, at least one of them, would like to take part in the group of councillors.
Councillor Cook, I think the committee did meet three or four times a year, but I think due to the pandemic, you're correct, it hasn't met recently.
Thank you for that.
Councillor Cameron, thank you.
Yes, you can see in your papers that it was a decision that we had to take at the Tourism Community's Culture and Leisure Committee. It seems to be another example of a change to what was agreed when we moved to the committee structure. It's never really explained as to why these things seem to be hoovered up. It says that the vacancies need to be filled, and as you rightly said, group leaders can do that. I would suggest that the vacancies that you currently have, councillors who couldn't stay in their seats, or councillors who need to take leave, but it should not be politically proportionate, and it should not turn into another situation where residents are really unhappy and they are outside the floral pavilion because they haven't been asked.
Thank you, Councillor Collins.
Thanks, Chair.
That was going so well until that intervention.
Councillor Steve Fowkes has made a proposal that we hand it on to the group leaders, and I'm very happy to actually second that proposal. We want to move this forward. Let's move it forward. Let's get it to the group leaders. Let them deal with it, and I think they can deal with it a lot better and a lot quicker. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Collins. I didn't actually take that as a proposal. We were talking about, it was questions and comments. So
I'm happy to propose that, because I was talking on the same lines. Could it just go back to group leaders?
And you can't actually propose anything if you're not speaking. So I would like, bearing in mind that we have potentially quite conflicting views here, and that it's turning quite political, and that it's actually something that's really very important to a lot of people. And I know there are councillors, we've even got councillors who have lived on Hilbury Island. So this is something that I think we need to really consider, that there is expertise out there that perhaps will not get to say and not get to share their ideas and their lived experience of Hilbury Island. So I would like to refer this to PNR. So I'm proposing that we refer this to PNR. It will be a very brief agenda item, I'm sure, but it allows the groups to think a little further on this. Yeah.
I just think, give it to the leaders. They know their councillors, they know their teams, and if someone's got relevant experience that wants to put the name forward, that's the time to do it. Let the leaders deal with it. PNR have got enough on their plate, and if this can be done in the group leaders meeting, I think we should let them do it.
So do I propose that we take it to PNR?
I would like technical advice. I know it sounds minimal and red tape, but somewhere, somehow, a decision and nominations will have to be moved. And the way to get all the leaders around the table to make a decision is to go to PNR. I know it sounds cumbersome, but there will have to be a decision somewhere, or we'd have to go to full council, because vacancies go to full council as well, which we've seen the other night. So my view, constitutionally, it probably has to go to PNR.
Just quickly take Councillor Cook before that's answered.
Yeah, having heard various viewpoints on this, I'm quite happy to say I support the idea of it going to PNR, season most. You see, if it goes to group leaders, that's not really democratic, because that's, every group just has, well, with the exception of one, just a leader and a deputy there. So, you could have a 3-2 split there, which didn't represent the proportionality between the groups anyway. So I think PNR is in best position to decide that.
Chair, can I finish? Can I make just... I find it really, really frustrating and quite condescending that you say this is getting political. This is getting political because you made it political, because you put it on the agenda. You, nobody else, chair of this meeting, put it on the agenda.
Extremely rude, pointing and calling someone you, tantamount to threatening behaviour. Please stop it.
I do actually object to that behaviour, Councillor Mountney, and I am quite surprised by it, to be honest. I'm really not happy. It was quite out of order, to be honest. However, officers suggested that this go on the committee because there are vacancies. It's perfectly reasonable. You were at the briefing as well when this was raised, and so this has been at the spokesperson's briefing. This has not been sprung on you, and I didn't put it here. We agreed to it collectively, going on the agenda at the agenda briefing. So that was a collective spokesperson decision. I'm not taking anything else on this because we've had a proposal and we've had a seconder, so I'd like to vote on that, please.
Took it from another committee. It was an active move on your part. This isn't some passive thing, and you're not going to get upset about it. You actively moved to take this.
Sorry, Councillor Cameron, you're talking through the chair. I have not said that you could speak. You've never asked to speak during this whole meeting. You have just put your microphone on and you've just spoken. That is really appalling behaviour. I wasn't going to call it out, but I'm prepared to call it out now. If you are going to deputise, could you please behave yourself? Now, I have proposed something. Something has been seconded, and I suggest we vote.
I suggest we do vote, Chair, but it's quite clear that we're not promoting, although the officers have put in, because that's what the Constitution would say, we're not promoting political ratios. We're not. Why are you trying to misinterpret? The officers write the report. We members make the decision. We started the debate by saying...
Were you at full council?
We started the debate by saying this is not a political ratio issue, and all three ward councillors who would treasure the island more, nearly said treasure island, would treasure the island more, would be on the committee. We're not obstructing... The officers are working within the Constitution and putting the alternatives for us. We've made a common sense alternative. PNR will decide, and I bet my bottom dollar PNR will come out with a non-political ratio because the three ward councils will be on it and interested parties. Why are you trying to use any single angle to attack the chair personally, which I've seen on numerous occasions? I also witnessed outside here, that Councillor Liz Gray, as she was entering the meeting, was pointed out and said, "Here's Liz Gray," to the objectors outside. Now, I don't think that is acceptable either. So please, let's not personalise it. Councillor Gray is the chair of a committee and carries out the democratic will of the committee.
I feel I'm being shouted at.
Can I just call order, please? I'd be very grateful if everybody could be quiet. And we have proposed, we have a proposal on the table and we have a seconder, and I would like that moved proposal be voted on now, please. Thank you. Vicky.
So, members, if we could have all those in favour of the proposal that the Environment, Climate and Emergency and Transport Committee recommends that the Policy and Resources Committee authorise the monitoring officer to carry out the wishes of the group leaders in relation to this matter. All those in favour? I think that's unanimous. Nobody against? No abstentions? No. Thank you, members.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Vicky. So this brings us to item 10, which is the work programme update, and this can be found on pages 121 to 128 of the agenda pack. And I think it's fairly self-explanatory. It's gratifying to see active travel in there. However, in light of full council yesterday and pending the outcome of the Standards Committee, I would like to see the democratic and unanimous vote of this committee upheld by officers, and that means that active travel funding and strategy should be back in there where they were when we voted as a committee to keep them in the work programme for this committee. Does anyone else have any comments about the work programme? No. Can I ask the committee to approve the recommendations on page 121 of the agenda pack with the additional recommendation that active travel items removed after we voted to keep them be restored to the work programme for this committee? So the recommendation would read, note the proposed Environment, Climate, Emergency and Transport Committee work programme for the remainder of the 21-22 municipal year, and the active travel items removed after we voted to keep them be restored to the work programme for this committee, including active travel funding and strategy. Seconded, thank you. Can we agree that on assent? By assent, thank you. Before that, this actually brings us very close to the end of the meeting, you'll be very glad to know. But I just want to remind members that there is a one-hour budget workshop tomorrow between 5 and 6 o'clock, which it would be a very good idea if we could all try and attend that, please. I'd like to thank everyone. This does bring us to the end of the agenda. I'd particularly like to thank the officers, some of whom have had to be very, very patient listening to us and waiting for us. So unless anyone else objects, I would now like to declare the meeting over.